Capital One Bowl Mania.
Old Yankee Stadium, the most recognizable touchstone of baseball history, has also been the site of memorable football moments, like the first game in 1923 when Syracuse beat Pitt 3-0. Notre Dame won one for the Gipper in 1928, and a game of the century as Army and Notre Dame battled to a scoreless tie in 1946. Now one block north of the original site, the tradition continues at New Yankee Stadium in the 10th New Era Pinstripe Bowl, all part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Mark D'Antonio has taken the Michigan State Spartans to 12 bowl games in his 13 years as head coach. Dave Clawson has now taken Wake Forest to its fourth consecutive bowl game for the first time in program history. First meeting between Michigan State and Wake Forest comes at Yankee Stadium, and we have a very unique perspective as well. Not too far away from the judges' chambers near the short porch here in right field. That's the right field foul pole. Adam Amin, Matt Hasselbeck, Paul Carcaterra is with us today as well. Unique atmosphere and perspective, especially for a Boston guy.
Yeah, this is really cool. I've seen, I think, three football games at Fenway Park, and it's a great environment. I'm excited to see what it's like here at Yankee Stadium. And we've got two good teams. Michigan State, you know, high expectations. They started out fast, struggled a little bit. It's a tough Big Ten. Going up against Wake Forest, a lot of people say, who's the second best team in the ACC, right, to Clemson in the Atlantic? It's got to be Wake Forest. Dave Clawson is a great football coach. I'm excited to see this matchup today.
An opportunity for a 9-win season for Clawson for the first time in over a decade. Michigan State won the toss and deferred. So it'll be Wake Forest's offense getting the ball first here at Yankee Stadium. Cole Hahn is the kickoff man with Kendall Hinton and Kenneth Walker back to return.
Cole Hahn, if you didn't know, I got my guy Joey over here some Cole Hahns for Christmas.
Very solid shoe maker, Cole Hahn. Wake Forest hasn't had a kick return touchdown since 2007. They won't have that chance here. It'll start with a penalty marker and good field position coming up for Wake Forest's offense, led by Jamie Newman. What a great story, and one of the really solid ACC quarterbacks, a three-star recruit from North Carolina, had a great high school pedigree, did Newman, a redshirt junior out of Graham, North Carolina. An all-ACC honorable mention, one of 14 all-ACC players for Wake this year, a school record. He was second in the ACC behind Bryce Perkins in total offense.
Yeah, Adam, and I called his first game ever, his first start against NC State. No film on him. I had to call his high school coach, and his high school coach said, he's going to remind you of Cam Newton, and he was right.
They'd love to run the read. He'll hand it off to Cade Carney, their leading rusher from the backfield, and he'll work it ahead for 5 yards.
And this is a very physical offensive style that Wake Forest has. It goes fast, very quick tempo. I call it a ride-read action between the quarterback and the running back.
You see it on display as Carney runs it to the sticks at the 45-yard line. They like to run plays every 10 to 12 seconds if they can, but then they ride that mesh point as long as any quarterback, running back duo in the country.
Yeah, and their goal is to run about 90 plays a game if they can. It makes it very tough to prepare for in practice.
There's Carney with a big hole. Three plays, three good runs. He takes this one for 13 and another first down to the 42.
We talked about the size of quarterback Jamie Newman. He's 6'4", every bit of 230. And then you throw in Cade Carney. He's close to 230 as well. They list him at about 220. Again, a very physical combination.
Newman will pump and now step up with nothing downfield and turn it into a positive play, running into Kenny Willekes after 7 yards.
And Kenny Willekes, he is the heart and soul of this defense. We had a chance to sit down with players and coaches of Michigan State this week. Kenny Willekes, I gotta just tell you, I don't know that I've been more impressed with a college football player that I've met this year than this guy. Former walk-on, turned MVP and captain of this team, obviously a scholarship player now, one of the top D linemen in the Big Ten.
There's Carney, who slips a tackle in the backfield and runs it to the 33, about a yard shy of the line to gain.
done a couple of Wake Forest games this year, and Cade Carney is not available in those games. This is where they would really like him available in short yardage situations.
They'll give it to him in the short yardage spot, and sure enough, he moves the sticks to the 29-yard line. Six plays, six runs for Wake Forest so far. Newman off the fake, launching for Kendall Hinton. Touchdown, Wake Forest. What a drive to open the day.
What a start for Wake Forest. They run the ball very effectively. Then they go with the hard play action. And they get Kendall Hinton on an inside slant and go. Perfectly executed for Wake Forest. Incredible start.
Beat the safety David Dowell on the first Newman pass of the day. Nick Skiba makes it a 7-0 lead. A couple of the best wide receivers for Wake Forest were hurt late in the year. Kendall Hinton was the man who stepped up. The former quarterback is now their leading pass catcher. He's got him out in front.
The New Era Pinstripe Bowl, brought to you by New Era. Visit us at neweracap.com. Capital One, what's in your wallet? And the Ford F-150, built Ford Tough.
Several of the Wake and Michigan State players, along with the coaches, rang the bell at the New York Stock Exchange on Thursday. I don't know if it's correlated, but the Dow ended up over 100 points. That's pretty solid.
That helps.
Kendall Hinton stepped into a major role, an even bigger role than before. The former quarterback had to become their leading target after Scotty Washington and their all-ACC wide receiver Sage Surratt both went down in the final third of the year. And Hinton, now their leading pass catcher with 71 grabs this year.
That's pretty good. You start out throwing touchdowns for your first 3 years, and then you end up just catching. Not bad.
Nick Skiba kicks away. Jalen Naylor, who returned late in the season from a foot injury, with a chance on the return. Spins away from the initial surge. And will get wrapped up at the 27-yard line by Leo Kelly.
Well, I was so impressed with the play calling here. They do a nice job of taking advantage of how intelligent David Dowell is as a safety. He knows that the RPO is coming, but they go with the RPO fake slant and go for the touchdown pass. I mentioned the run game was working. RPO comes right off of it. Excellent play call. Perfect execution by Wake Forest.
So now Brian Lewerke, in his final collegiate game, will start with a pass, and he connects with Cody White, who's had a career season. We talked with Brian Lewerke yesterday. He is well aware that he is at the top or near the top of several Michigan State records, and he needs just now 26 completions to break the completion record as he finds Jalen Naylor. Got hit hard by the cornerback Amari Henderson. No gain on that play, and it's third down. Brian Lewerke's had an up and down career in the estimation of a lot of Michigan State fans. And if you talk to Mark D'Antonio, he has full faith in what Brian Lewerke has been able to do. When you're at the top of the list by Kirk Cousins or by Connor Cook, you've had an excellent career.
Yeah, and I think he's a really good player. He's had a couple turnovers late in the season that have hurt him, but he's got a chance to prove something tonight.
Lofts it up there looking for Darryl Stewart, who is questionable as well. He is back and healthy. Incomplete, though, and it brings up fourth down. Lewerke, up and down career. His season was up and down. He led the Big Ten in completions, but also led the Big Ten in interceptions with 12. Trying to see if he can find a groove in his final collegiate game before the NFL PA Collegiate Bowl.
Yeah, and there's some criticism on him, but they've started 7 left tackles. I think that's tough for any quarterback. It's going to be tough tonight because Wake Forest has one of the best pass rushers in the country in Boogie Basham.
Jake Hartbarger, not a great punt, but will end up at 33 yards. Decent field position once again for Wake Forest. Talking about the Michigan State defense, Josiah Scott is the feature in our PlayStation player impact rating, is rating 97 out of 100. You see the three interceptions he had this year. Only Antoine Winfield of Minnesota had more. We asked his teammate Josh Butler to describe him. He used one very impressive word.
That's right, Adam. He said dominant. And I'll just tell you, he's a good tackler for a corner. He's quick. He's got spectacular technique. Really the best corner on the field. Plays that field corner. Means if the ball's in the left hash, he's going to be on the left side here. He's a good player.
Lined up against Stephen Claude. Playing his final game. Hand off to Carney. And minimal yardage on the play as Willekes is there for the stop.
Yeah, Willekes is there for the stop. And one of the things he told us that he had to be aware of, when Jamie Newman feels like you're going to get penetration and make a tackle on the running back, he'll just keep the ball himself. And then you almost got to redirect and then go from tackling the running back to tackling the quarterback. He said Jamie Newman's, you know, one of the most disruptive guys as an offensive quarterback. He said his plan is to play in the backfield.
Newman whips one to his left and finds Donovan Green, the true freshman, who's playing in his fourth game. Had a great finale against Syracuse. Kark?
You know, you're talking about Jamie Newman. This guy's a beast. I was about 10 yards from him before he joined the field. And I spoke to Asong Bassi, who's one of their cornerbacks. He said, this guy is a beast in the weight room. He lifts with the linemen and the fullbacks. He's not lifting with quarterbacks like Matt Hasselbeck. He wants to be tested.
He tested there as he had to get away from the initial pressure and uses his legs for the first down out across the 45. Run down by David Dowell, the safety.
Well, this is just an excellent job by Jamie Newman. A free rusher comes right up the middle. I believe it was Harvey. And Jamie Newman shows that basketball ability, making guys miss in the hole right there.
Stepping around pressure, but he gets wrapped up and brought down. Excellent penetration by Jacob Slade, a redshirt freshman from Ohio.
Well, all the basketball quickness in the world can't get you out of this one. Slade makes a nice play right off the jump, gets into the backfield. It's a good thing that he did because Newman had receivers open on that play.
First career sack for Jacob Slade. Newman went into a very tight window, and he's able to find Brandon Chapman, the tight end. So they'll get that lost yardage back and set up a third down and 9.
And the tempo that Wake Forest is playing with here is just really impressive. Michigan State's defenders are sprinting off the field and barely getting off the field in time.
Newman's got time. Looking for the comeback route with Donovan Green, the closest man to it. It's going to bring up fourth down.
And I really like this Donovan Green. He's a freshman. He hasn't played a ton. But he has such high, he's got high-end ability. Like, his ceiling might be the highest of this wide receiver group that we'll see today. See a little bit of miscommunication there, and that's part of what happens when you're playing a lot of freshmen, not something that Wake Forest typically does.
And Green entered the season late. Today is his fourth game as a true freshman, so he can retain his redshirt. Brandon Sowards, the sixth-year senior, is back to return a Don Maggio punt. Second team All-ACC punter delivers one inside the 5, but it'll head out to the 20, a net punt of 30. 6 minutes in here at Yankee Stadium. Michigan State's got the ball.
Where most players on senior day are accompanied by family, Josh Butler decided to step onto Spartan Stadium one last time with his beloved two dogs by his side, Roxy and Remy. Nothing can prepare you for what Butler has gone through. During his college career, the Texas native lost his father, Stephen, in 2017 to a heart attack. A year and a half later, his mother, Ladrita Bagley, passed from breast cancer. He wears his father's crematory tag around his neck and a pink ribbon tattoo on his left shoulder area for a constant reminder of them. We spent time with him, gentlemen. He's an amazing, strong young man. During these hard times, not only has he played college football and graduated, he has a master's degree.
He told us yesterday that he wants to go into film production. He got his master's in media and info, and Roxy and Remy, his two dogs that he adopted in between the deaths of his parents. The boxer bulldog mixes were right by his side. He said those dogs have helped him cope with a lot of the tragedy and adversity that he has had to deal with. Elijah Collins gets hit hard by Ryan Smenda of Wake Forest, the inside linebacker. There are a few players that I've left the conversation with being as impressed as I was with Josh Butler. What an incredible young man. Obviously a great heartwarming piece to that story with his dogs who have been by his side, but it is impossible not to want to root for that young man.
Yeah, and he said his goal was to be a light to others, and he's certainly doing that. He's shared his experience with other people who've had similar experiences, and what a kid.
Jalen Naylor, good grab and good run. Doesn't look like that broken foot that he suffered in practice after the opener is affecting him too much now.
Well, you'll see a lot of this as a way to protect the run game. It is a run called, and if it's a bad look for the run, Lewerke will just pull it and throw that little smoke route, a little now route to the wide receiver, let the wide receiver do the rest, and Naylor is good for 23 there.
Sets him up at the 41-yard line. Lewerke off the fake, a little too tall for Darryl Stewart. That'll bring up second down. So Jalen Naylor broke his foot in practice after the opener at Tulsa, but did return for the final two games when they were able to win against Rutgers and Maryland to secure bowl eligibility. Darryl Stewart played eight games before he suffered a leg injury against Penn State in late October. So this game is the first time since the opener that Cody White, Darryl Stewart, and Jalen Naylor, the top three receivers, are all together for Brian Lewerke at Michigan State.
Yeah, injuries have been a real problem for both teams this season, but Naylor's their fastest receiver, so having that explosiveness out there today is going to be huge.
Go with a little jet sweep to Anthony Williams, another running back, a true freshman from Chicago, and he works his way to the sticks for a first down.
Yeah, I like Anthony Williams. He's kind of an all-purpose guy. He's got a lot of juke to him. You know, he's not the biggest guy necessarily. You know, he's a true freshman, but I like what I've seen out of him. They use him very creatively. They use him in the passing game, the running game, you see him in the return game some.
But their three main running backs are a redshirt freshman in Elijah Collins and two true freshmen in Brandon Wright and Anthony Williams. Lewerke rifles to the sideline for Naylor. If he's in bounds, that's a first down. But it's going to be ruled out of bounds. He had Jasir Taylor, the quarterback, marking him on the sideline.
Yeah, this is a timing route, and really, it's a good enough throw. Naylor has to spin all the way around for it for some reason, and the first foot that hits the ground happened to be out of bounds. That would have been a nice first down. Instead, it's second and 10, and this is not an ideal situation for a play caller. You're trying to get at least half of it back here, trying to get to a third and five situation if you can.
Back to the ground. Nice shiftiness by Anthony Williams and some of the speed on display as he takes it for 9 yards to the 40.
And again, you know, sometimes people get frustrated. Why do you call a running play on second and long? Well, here's why. They're expecting maybe a pass. You're trying to get maybe 5 yards. Instead, you get nine. You're right where you want to be in a short yardage third and one situation.
And Lewerke will try to sneak it ahead, needing just a yard. Lewerke at 6'3", 216 pounds is his listed vitals.
And he's a pretty good runner. I mean, they use him on some designed runs, but when it comes to the quarterback sneak, I think most offensive linemen and most quarterbacks will tell you the best thing you can do on a quarterback sneak is get up there quick with tempo and quick count it. Don't let that defensive line, you know, see what's coming, kind of hunker down, get locked in. Try to surprise them.
They do give him the first down. Max Rosenthal, the fullback, is in. Lewerke has nothing downfield, so a very good runner will take off and take some contact. Brian Lewerke is the only Michigan State quarterback in its program's history with 7,000 plus passing yards and 1,000 plus rushing yards.
And what I really appreciate about what he did on that play, they went with the double move, like out ducks. They tried to take a shot downfield, and it wasn't there. Instead of panicking or just throwing it up for grabs, he tucked it, he ran, he got about 7 yards, maybe eight. Now they're almost in field goal range. Smart play by the upperclassmen.
Here's Collins. may have gotten caught up in the turf there as he was trying to maneuver. Ends up losing a yard on the play with Ryan Smenda on top of him. Elijah Collins trying to become the first 1,000-yard rusher for Michigan State in 5 years. Jeremy Langford had back-to-back 1,000-yard seasons. In fact, he had 1,400 and then 1,500 back in 2013 and 14.
And everybody talks about the same thing with Elijah Collins. They say he's got great vision. He looks up to Le'Veon Bell as a runner. But the vision that he has, really impressive for such a young player.
A fake to him in the pistol. A little RPO and a completion to Cody White for the first down.
That was like an RPO. We're either going to run it with Elijah Collins, or we're going to run it with Lewerke. And then when you here's the run here. We're going to run it with Elijah Collins. Oh, we don't like that. We're going to run it with the quarterback. Oh, and by the way, there's one more option. We got Cody White. That's tough to defend. I give these college defensive coordinators a lot of credit. These offenses out here in college football are very, very creative and tough to defend.
Interesting formation here, too. He throws to the bunch set, and Darryl Stewart makes the grab. But a good job in open space by Isang Bassi, the captain and third-year starter, making the stop.
Yeah, and all they're trying to do with these formations early on, they're going to see what the adjustments are. So they went to an empty backfield set with four eligible receivers to the right side, and they realized that Wake Forest was really unfazed, unaffected. They didn't shift at all. So that now leads you to other plays in your playbook.
Right.
But essentially, that was a pass that was really just blocked like a run.
Back to Collins. Good hole opened up by this offensive line. And Elijah Collins powers his way inside the 10. First down and goal, Michigan State. Trey Rucker finally brought him down after 15.
Well, check out the actions. Freeze 41, Ja'Cory Johns. And then Elijah Collins does the rest. The eye distraction pre-snap with the motion and all the stuff in the backfield has Wake Forest defense on their heels. And then Elijah Collins just does the rest. Now, Michigan State, they've had some struggles in the red zone.
Yes.
Their touchdown efficiency is 110th in college football. That's not very good at all.
51% touchdown rate in the red zone. They were really good 2 years ago. They've struggled the last couple of seasons. Here's Collins. He gets wrapped up by Chase Jones, the true freshman. About a yard on the play to the 5. This is where the frustrations have lied, really, with Brian Lewerke in the offense. He talked to us about it the other day. He said, I need to find the plays that I like and the receivers that I like, and I think I can cash in today.
Yeah, it's tough. In red zone efficiency, you know, it's a small sample size sometimes.
Yeah.
You know, you get four opportunities down there, you score once, you say, oh, we only had 25%. You got to make them count when you do get the opportunities. They got one right here.
Lewerke being chased. Ryan Smenda was in the backfield quickly, forcing Lewerke into a tough spot. Third down and goal.
Yeah, Smenda comes right up the middle, really untouched, gets through. And again, Lewerke does a nice job. Smart player, he's a senior quarterback, throws the ball away.
Potential four down territory too early in the game.
I don't think this is four down territory. No, that decision is made right now. That decision was already made and told into Brad Salem, the offensive coordinator. So this play is going to be probably trying to get a touchdown because you know 3 points is in the bag already.
Lewerke being chased. Tough throw. Incomplete. You had Ja'Cory Johns and Boogie Basham both in the area by Lewerke, and he had to get rid of it.
But when I see cut blocks up front, that's when you realize the ball's got to come out quick. But nobody was open quick, so Lewerke once again has to throw the ball away, and the field goal team comes on, which is really not a terrible thing. I know as a quarterback, it's hard to walk off the field and throw the ball away on third down, but great quarterback coaches say this all the time. Let end every drive with a kick. Whether that's a field goal, extra point, or even a punt. Can't have a turnover.
So Matt Coughlin, who has missed 9 field goals this year, part of that is because they've had to kick so many. That was his 30th attempt on the season. He gets Michigan State on the board. Take a look at our Expedia Drive recap. Brian Lewerke went to work, getting multiple guys involved, starting with Jalen Naylor.
Well, and the most important thing for me is this is a long drive. This is a 16-play drive, spreading it around, and it gives the defense time to breathe. And they did it with the passing game, and they did it with the running game. Elijah Collins was big on that one. They come away with 3 points, which Mark D'Antonio is not going to be happy about. But I like the fact that it was a long drive. Lewerke did a nice job of throwing the ball away when things weren't there.
Took 6.5 minutes off the clock. Lewerke did not make the mistake, and that's been one of the criticisms of Brian Lewerke. 12 interceptions this year. Made good decisions to get rid of the ball on that series. So Cole Haan will kick away. Walker and Hinton both back to return. Kick one out of bounds last time. This will be shorter, and Hinton will grab it at the 6. He's got a good hole, but a penalty marker is thrown as he tumbles down at the 39-yard line. Cole Haan helped bring him down. This one may end up coming back.
Holding by number 86 of the receiving team. It's a 10-yard penalty, and it's first down.
Jack Frutenthal on the penalty. We go down to the field to check in with Paul Carcaterra with a special guest.
I'm with the most important person in Yankee Stadium. It's Dan Cunningham, 31 years as the head groundskeeper. And the stadium looks amazing. I got to ask you first, how long does it take you to transform baseball to football?
About a week. It takes about a week to get it all tucked in, and expand the playing field into the dugouts, and cover all indications of the. You take the mound out, the infield, and just make it look like a good football field and play like a football field.
It looks and playing like a football field. What would you say the biggest challenge, Dan, as we see Wake Forest on a 3-yard run?
Biggest challenge for me or is
for you, for your crew to get it to this state?
The biggest challenge is working with the weather and this time of the year. It's usually cold, it's freezing, it could be snowing, but right now it seems to be playing fantastic, so we're very happy right now.
You're very happy, but you also could be a little bit nervous during the preparation stages. What keeps you up at night when you know football's coming to Yankee Stadium?
Weather. Weather's always on the horizon. Worried about the weather and how it's going to affect the game and how it's going to affect the way we operate as a team.
And how about the difference in the type of players, too, when you prepare for baseball players as opposed to these guys?
Totally different. They're a different athlete. They're, as you see, they're... But the baseball players are good size themselves, but these guys are just...
How about Mike Panashuk with a pick 6 for Michigan State? In his 51st career Michigan State game and his final one. What a play.
Adam, we talked about it all year. Tips and overthrows, gotta get those. That's exactly what happened here. I think it was his little brother, Jacob, who actually tips it. And then big brother off the back of another teammate, I think it was Harvey, tips and overthrows, gotta get those. And then he gets into the end zone all by himself. We've got a big man touchdown. Anytime somebody 300 plus scores, there's a party going on everywhere where there's a big guy. Congratulations to big brother Mike.
Unsportsmanlike conduct by number 72 of Michigan State. Penalty will be assessed on the kickoff. It's number 72's first unsportsmanlike conduct foul of the game.
Of course, there is a celebration penalty. You said it, the Panashuk brothers. Mike is older by 1 year. They both come to Michigan State together from Roselle, Illinois, Lake Park West High School. The sons of Polish immigrants in suburban Chicago often speak Polish to one another on the field, sometimes to deliver messages, sometimes just to mess with the offensive linemen. Those two are as tight as they come, and they team up for a big man touchdown, and the Spartans have a 10-7 lead.
And he gets the penalty for taking the helmet off, but I just got to tell you, as if everyone doesn't already know, bald is beautiful, and he just had to show it off. I mean, this is Yankee Stadium. It's like a little tip
it's
of the cap.
It's a tip of the cap right there. That's a home run if I've ever seen one here at Yankee Stadium.
And you saw the coach go over there to him, and he say, hey, act like you've been there before. And
I don't think he's been there before, man.
He's been here before.
It is his second career interception. He had one against Northwestern last year, but this time he pumped it into the end zone with the help of his big brother.
Very impressive. A defensive tackle with the first touchdown today for Michigan State. Who would have thought? Here he is. Take another bow. And I think that was right at home plate,
yeah,
where he was taking the snap.
He ran it right into home plate.
And look at his brother. You know, siblings are often very different, right? You got the brother,
yep,
you know, looking for the camera, looking for all the glory. Little brother Jacob's just over there, in the nose, out the mouth. Getting ready to go out and play some more defense.
They would travel back to Poland during their summers. They would work on their family farm. Mike would raise the livestock, and Jacob would pitch all the hay. Oftentimes, they would get into fights with each other, arguing on the farm. They bloodied each other up. They helped each other out for some points that time. Walker takes it out across the 40. A good return on the backed-up kickoff with the penalty. That's one of the hallmarks of this Michigan State program. They have five sets of brothers on this team, tied for the most in the country with Nebraska and Clemson.
I got to imagine that helps in recruiting when you're hosting someone who's your little brother. You know, we mentioned Kenny Willekes earlier. His little brother's on the team as well. It's a strong program for Michigan State. I like what they've got defensively. You know, Jamie Newman, he's being evaluated by NFL scouts. There's some NFL scouts here today. I'd like to see how he bounces back after getting a bad bounce there on the interception for a touch.
We'll ride that read with Kenneth Walker, and good penetration by Michigan State. They get Jacob Slade into the backfield. That's something you talked about, Matt. You have to have penetration to kind of blow up this Ryan Reed and this tempo.
Yeah, they have developed, Dave Clawson and company have kind of developed this Ryan Reed action over 20 years. I don't know of anybody else who does it this way. Getting penetration in the backfield is the best way that I know of to stop it.
Donovan Green makes the grab for six.
And again, this tempo. Mark D'Antonio told us that they practiced with three different huddles to go quickly in practice just to try to simulate this.
Looking for Green with a flag down. It was broken up momentarily, and then it was caught. Shakur Brown deflected it, but Donovan Green came down with it. It may be a moot point as there's a flag back at the 40-yard line.
This is one of the most incredible catches I have ever seen.
Personal foul, a chop block by number 75 and 25. Correct. 79 and 25. It's a 15-yard penalty in replay third down.
Kenneth Walker and Sean McGinn, a high-low engaged block, so a penalty for a chop block negates it.
And it's really unfortunate. Sometimes when you have a true freshman going in there to try to block somebody, they get him low. And sometimes you don't realize that the offensive lineman might be engaged. It's kind of tough to see from that angle. But check out this play defensively and then offensively. We mentioned Donovan Green and that high-end ability that he has. This was an incredible play. Not his fault that this is coming back.
Negates a 48-yard spectacular play. And it sets up third down and 20. Newman being chased. Still has some ground to cover. He got hit by Josiah Scott right at midfield, just a couple of yards shy of the line to gain. But I feel like if you're a quarterback now, you're going, hey, I got 18. Can we get two more?
Yeah, and he gets Raekwon Williams, gets him right in the back after that. I think the coaching point there for Jamie Newman is don't slow down. Keep going, and you're going to learn the hard way. Taking a hit like that by a nose tackle, Raekwon Williams is up over 300 pounds. That was a big hit.
Brandon Sowards back to return. Maggio will boot it away. Fair catch at the 11. Well, obviously, it is the heart of Capital One Bowl Mania. We've got our quadruple header today on ESPN. The final two of the evening. Number 25, Oklahoma State. You get to see the great Canadian running back, Chuba Hubbard, against Texas A&M. And then the Cheez-It Bowl, Air Force and Washington State tonight. If it's anything like last year's Cheez-It Bowl, I highly recommend you tune in, starting up when we're done here at Yankee Stadium.
Yeah, and I think our guy Pat McAfee might be out at the Cheez-It Bowl.
He's an ambassador for the Cheez-It Bowl. There is no better brand the brand.
That Washington State offense is fun to watch as well.
Anthony Gordon had a great season offensively this year as Collins gets wrapped up at the line of scrimmage. And that takes us to the end of what was a very entertaining opening quarter of play. Wake Forest scored on its opening drive. Spartans with a field goal and then a big man touchdown to make it a 10-7 game at the 10th New Era Pinstripe Bowl. First meeting all time between these two out of the Big Ten and ACC.
Football playoff.
On the eve of the college football playoff, you're watching the New Era Pinstripe Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. The 14th bowl game of the FBS slate out of the 40 that you'll get exposed to over the course of this season, including the national championship game in mid-January on a Monday night from New Orleans.
Yeah, think about the rich tradition of defensive backs here at Michigan State. And the first touchdown comes from who? A defensive lineman.
Yeah.
Well done.
Seems about right. And for the last couple of seasons, it's been the defense of Michigan State that has been its calling card. This has been an anemic offense the last 2 years. Well, Michigan State hoping for better days ahead and trying to close out Brian Lewerke's career in a positive fashion. On second and 10. Lofts one up there looking for Julian Barnett, the freshman. He's already thrown the most passes of any Michigan State quarterback ever. He's within the reach of the completion mark with a big offensive day. He's within the reach of the total offense mark, which is one that he was well aware of. Connor Cook owns that record currently. Kirk Cousins owns the completion record.
Yeah, listen, there have been some great quarterbacks to come through Michigan State. And he even mentioned, you know, how's a kid from Arizona who used to live in Tacoma get to Michigan State? He said, I met Kirk Cousins on my recruiting trip. And he said he had me just sold on Michigan State.
Got a relationship with Cousins ever since. Slipping tackles, Lewerke will get hit at the 15-yard line. Ryan Smenda, the leading tackler for this Wake Forest defense, was there for the stop. This is a Wake Forest defense that's missing probably three of its best five or so players. Nasir Greer not playing in the bowl game at safety after he had surgery, a knee injury to him. Their captain, Justin Sternad, has been out since the Florida State game. He's their second leading tackler still in only 8 starts. And then Luke Masterson, who's their hybrid guy, he is out with an undisclosed injury. He missed the last 7 games.
Yeah, Sternad's the quarterback of that defense, and it's not so much the amount of injuries here with Wake Forest, it's who got hurt. A lot of big players.
Fair catch from Kendall Hinton. Well, bowl season rolls on tomorrow with the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic from AT&T Stadium in Arlington. Number 17, Memphis, moving past Mike Norvell, who took the Florida State job, getting set to take on 10th-ranked Penn State. Noon Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app. Now let's take a look at, you're going to love this pun, what's in store this postseason, brought to you by Macy's, which is right down the road. This is what we've got in the non-playoff New Year's 6 games coming up.
Yeah, we got some great games there. I love watching Virginia and that offense, but one of my favorite games that we got to call this year was going down to Baylor.
Yeah.
Love what Matt Rhule's done down there.
We'll see if Charlie Brewer is healthy, still dealing with the aftermath of being in the concussion protocol after the Big 12 championship loss in overtime. Cade Carney gets swarmed after a yard gain. Wake had that impressive opening series. Scored a touchdown with the Jamie Newman pass, but haven't been able to get much going since. Carney got grabbed at the ankles by Tyreek Thompson at the 41-yard line.
And really, that's so much of what happens in these football games, Adam. You come out with your first 15 plays, your starters, and you see how they're going to react. And then you get over the first time you get on the bench, and you make those adjustments, and you go to your next set of plays.
Looking that time for Stephen Claude in double coverage, fourth down.
And that's a great example right there. They say, okay, we know that we're getting one-on-one coverage on the backside. If we put a trips formation into the boundary, we're going to get a one-on-one. Who do we want? We want Claude, and we're going to take a shot. They took their shot. It was well covered. And really, that's where I see, from what I saw of Wake Forest earlier in the year, that was Sage Surratt right there. That would have been
yes.
his play.
Yep.
And because of the injuries that you were just mentioning, you know, you just move right on down the list, and that time it was Stephen Claude, another good player, but again, Sage Surratt, he's been their guy, the go-to guy.
Sowerts will head out of bounds, and Michigan State will take over. Yesterday was the 100-year anniversary of Babe Ruth being sold from the Red Sox to the Yankees. You get a chance to be in Monument Park today.
Baby Ruthie!
The New Era Pinstripe Bowl, brought to you by New Era. Visit us at neweracap.com and NerdWallet. For all your money questions, turn to the nerds at NerdWallet.
Well, as part of Bowl Week, the teams visited the Sloan Kettering Cancer Hospital up the Upper East Side, oldest private cancer center in the world. Players visited the pediatric wing and got to play some games, hang out with the kids. An awesome experience for both parties, and certainly one of the great things about bowl season, the community service that these teams do should be commended.
Yeah, this is really an incredible experience in terms of bowl games. New York City, obviously one of the greatest cities in all of the world, but Dave Clawson was talking about how his kids got to go to the World Trade Center, the New York Stock Exchange. He even made them go to the Radio City Music Hall Christmas Spectacular, and sounds like everybody really, really loved it.
We'll start with a jet sweep for Williams on this series. We'll pick up a couple. Boogie Basham is in the area. That's a name that you're going to want to know. And Wake Forest fans are excited because that's a name they're going to hear for another season. Carlos Basham Jr. is coming back for his senior year. The first Wake Forest defensive end to earn first-team All-ACC in 17 years. Calvin Pace, the last to do it.
Yeah, and where he's really special is on third down in pass rush situations. And he was going to probably be a second or a third round pick, and he came back to school because he's got hopes of being a first rounder.
Good hole opens up for Elijah Collins. Closes up relatively quickly, though, by Ryan Smenda, their excellent tackler. And it'll set up a third down and medium.
And we mentioned third down, and Boogie Basham, this is his down. He's a pass rusher. Adam, you and I, we call Thursday night football games, and a lot of NFL scouts attend those Thursday nights. And the guy that they were coming to watch was Boogie Basham. They wanted to learn more about him in case he came out early. Yes, he's coming back for another year at Wake, but his pass rush ability is special.
There he is trying to work inside. Lewerke got rid of it quickly. I think it was incomplete, and it was. Julian Barnett could not hang on to complete the process.
It's an incomplete pass. It's fourth down.
Nice job by Isak Bassi in the area.
And this is a good play call. They get the ball out on time, but again, drops. Massey with a nice job of making a hit, but they've been, I think they're number three in the country in drop passes. You're not gonna win enough football games if you're number three in the country in dropping the ball.
Almost 40 drops in now 13 games for Michigan State players. Their running backs have been guilty of that this year as well.
Wow, this is a good punt.
Great punt. Pat McAfee would be proud. Kendall Hinton from the 28-yard line. With a big hole and a good return, and he slips free, and the punter, Jake Hartbarger, is able to save a touchdown on a 36-yard return by Hinton, the longest of his career by far.
Well, as our guy Pat McAfee would say, this was good for the brand, an incredible punt. Kendall Hinton has had an excellent game. That's a 54-yard gain. Would have been a touchdown, but Hartbarger, the punter, with a great tackle, and might have even injured Kendall Hinton on the tackle. Looks like he might have injured himself just a little bit too, but some people say that the punt is the most exciting play in all of football.
Hartbarger in his sixth year, 54th and final Michigan State game. Makes an impact on that tackle, but a great return by Wake Forest's Kendall Hinton to set up the Demon Deacons at the 36. And a penalty marker is thrown from the near side.
A false start by number 82 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still first down.
Javez Alexander on the penalty. Well, this season, for every field goal and extra point made by participating universities, Allstate will make a contribution to the university's general scholarship fund. Walker and pounded across the 35-yard line. Get that penalty yardage back, and then some.
Really patient run by Kenneth Walker there. You know, you mentioned that Wake Forest doesn't play a lot of true freshmen. So if you play, you must be pretty talented, pretty special, and that's what Kenneth Walker is.
Up there, just a little bit of a surge ahead. Third down coming up.
If I'm Jamie Newman on this third down, I got to be aware of number 48, Kenny Willekes.
Yep. Haven't called his name much so far today. Here's Newman. They love the design runs with Jamie Newman. And that's a touchdown saving tackle by Shakur Brown. 18 yards to move the chains for Newman.
Well, they ran the opposite way of Willekes. Michigan State, they get caught in a blitz. They bring an outside blitz, and Jamie Newman goes right up inside. Some people say solve the riddle right up the middle when they want to blitz you outside. That's what Jamie Newman did. Wake Forest in the red zone.
And a handoff for Walker. Ooh, unable to keep his feet after a Josiah Scott dive to the ankles.
Josiah Scott mentioned earlier he's the best cover corner, but he's a good tackler. Sometimes you don't get that in a defensive back, but Josiah Scott's got it both.
Newman keeps it. Ooh, got stacked up running into Tyreek Thompson.
We mentioned earlier that Michigan State struggles in the red zone. Well, same thing for Wake Forest.
Yep.
For whatever reason, these guys also struggle. They're 101st in red zone touchdown efficiency. This is their first trip to the red zone. Let's see what they can do with it.
54% touchdown rate. Newman trying to throw to one-on-one. Donovan Green reaching out. What a catch! Touchdown Wake Forest, pending the penalty.
They could have thrown a couple flags on this one. There was holding inside on Kendall Hinton. Looked like there's probably holding outside on Donovan Green. We mentioned that this guy stepped up, true freshman. Nice catch.
Prior to the pass, holding by number 19 of the defense. The penalty is declined. It's a touchdown.
Josh Butler with the holding penalty, but moot point. Donovan Green, the true freshman from North Carolina, stumbling and still catching it.
It's really not bad coverage anywhere. This is just a nice job of giving the receiver an opportunity for a back shoulder throw. Adam, you've heard me say it 100 times. If it's going to be a back shoulder throw, make it a back shoulder throw, not in between. And it's got to be left shoulder pad or higher there. That's what it does, and it gives the wide receiver an opportunity to adjust to the ball. Donovan Green with a great catch.
Skiba for the extra point on a play that could have gone either way. So maybe Green push off a little, Butler with a little bit of a hold. But Donovan Green has stepped up in a big way for Wake. Well, last week, some major news was made in New York. Over $300 million to sign one of the best pitchers in the game. Gerrit Cole coming to New York, wearing the number 45. Will his number be the next one in Monument Park? That's where our buddy Paul Carcaterra is.
Well, Adam, this is my 7th Pinstripe Bowl, but actually the first time I've been in Monument Park. The Bronx is special for me. I spent the first few years of my life here. My father went to Cardinal Hayes High School right up the road. but this place is extra special. 22 jerseys have been retired in Monument Park. You have the plaques of the greats, of the Derek Jeters and the Joe DiMaggio's, Lou Gehrig, but this one's my favorite. George Herman Babe Ruth. 100 years ago yesterday, the curse of the Bambino. How does that sound to a Red Sox fan, Matt Hasselbeck?
I'm not going to comment on that.
Hey, the curse has been lifted, right?
I guess. The curse has been lifted multiple times
at this point.
What are we talking about? Hey, this is really cool. I grew up a lifelong Red Sox fan. Fenway Park was my spot. This is my first time here to Yankee Stadium. This is an awesome stadium.
Really cool.
It's a great place to watch a baseball game, obviously. But it's pretty cool to watch a football game up here, too.
One of the most expensive stadiums in the country. Nearly $2 billion spent to build new Yankee Stadium. Jalen Naylor on the return, takes it out near the 30-yard line. I don't think Kevin Negandhi wants to hear about this. He wants to hear about Citizens Bank Park. What do you got, Negandhi? I can hear the disdain in Kevin's voice. Not for Mac Brown, because he loves Mac Brown, but his Owls did not have a great showing in that bowl game today. Nothing there for Elijah Collins. Excellent penetration. Jaquez Williams on the outside.
Yeah, Jaquez Williams is one of those guys that's had to step up with Justin Strnad being out. And, you know, he just moved to linebacker this spring. He was playing basically the rover position, which is more like a defensive back. And he's bulked up a little bit, and he's had to step up. And that's been a big loss for this Wake Forest team. But between him and Schmenda, they've stepped up nicely.
Lewerke airing it out. Trenton Gillison makes the grab. There goes the redshirt freshman still on his feet. First down and goal, Michigan State. The biggest grab of Gillison's career. Well, 64 yards, man.
They usually say never throw the ball late down the middle if you're a quarterback. Lewerke says, the heck with that. This is my last game at Michigan State. He hits Gillison looking like a young Chris Baker out there. Ooh. Tight end running right down the pipe. Huge play.
And now Lewerke will dive for the goal line. He's in. Touchdown, Michigan State.
Adam, we mentioned an RRPO, a run, then a run, and then maybe a pass. Nope, the work he says, I'm going to keep it all by myself. He dives in, clearly a touchdown. That's indisputable video evidence. No need to review it. Well done by the senior quarterback after a huge play to the tight end right down the middle.
Gillison had made 8 grabs, and his longest was for 19 before that 64-yarder, which helped set up Lewerke's 3rd rushing touchdown of the season. Trenton Gillison, top tight end of the state of Ohio in high school, ends up in Michigan State. The biggest catch of his young Michigan State career, and Ryan Lewerke making his 38th career start for the Spartans, dives in for the score.
Stream your favorite sports, stories, and series with ESPN Plus, Disney Plus, and Hulu. Get all 3 for just $12.99 a month.
Well, coming into the bowl game, 17 players on offense, including 9 starters, had missed a total of 82 games for Michigan State. Today, their top pass-catching tight end, Matt Seibert, is out due to injury. They lost Matt Dotson to a torn Achilles at tight end back in the Illinois game. So now they're leaning on 3 freshmen at tight end. How about stepping up? Trenton Gillison setting up the Lewerke touchdown.
Not your typical tight end route. You know, usually you see tight ends catching Y option routes, an 8-yard out, post route maybe, a corner. Not right down the middle of the field on a game like that.
Kendall Hinton back on the field. Had a good punt return on his last touch. And his shiftiness will take him out across the 30 with a penalty marker thrown.
Well, guys, I mentioned the tight end not usually getting it. There's the tight end right here. If you could run the play, Lewerke's going to look left. And when he looks left over here, everybody drops the tight end going straight down the middle of the field.
Holding by number 89 of the receiving.
And that's really how he got wide open.
And it's first down.
This defense is well coached. They know that quarterbacks are not supposed to throw the ball late down the middle. That's what Lewerke does, and it worked out perfectly for Michigan State. 64-yard gain.
Brian Lewerke, the longest completion of his career in his 38th start. Long prior to that was 60 yards. The holding penalty on A.T. Perry will set Wake Forest back to its own 20-yard line. Just over 8 minutes to play first half. Cade Carney. Solid run of about 4.5. Running into Mike Panache.
And when you're running up inside like that with pulling guards, pulling offensive linemen, it really takes that outside defensive end pass rush out of it. We mentioned Kenny Willekes so much. He's coming outside. We're running right up inside of it. It's no big deal.
Willekes was bringing some pressure, but he may have lost his feet. Newman ended up throwing incomplete to Jaquari Roberson.
And some of this tempo, I think the tempo is so impressive, again, with Wake Forest. And they do a great job. They've got three guys here. They're shielding the signals. We're in a baseball stadium. There's three guys. One guy's live. Two guys are dummy signalers. And they get these plays in so quickly.
I'm sure Yankee fans aren't worried about signaling or anything like that in various playoff series. There's a run for Jamie Newman out across the 30. And he's got the first down. Antoine Simmons finally closes out the play.
And you really think about signaling, your third base coach in baseball, but it's so much in college football.
Right.
The NFL, there's the coach to quarterback communication system, basically a walkie-talkie right into the helmet of the quarterback. In college, the quarterbacks are on the sidelines hearing the play and then signaling it in to the quarterback.
Boy, Jamie Newman, how did he get out of the pack? What an elusive run by Newman into Michigan State territory. Picks up 19 yards. He looked like he was dead to rights a couple times.
Well, we mentioned he looks like Cam Newton. Ride Reed, they bring the corner blitz. It's Josiah Scott is a good tackler. And Jamie Newman basically says, get off of me, with a huge gain up the middle. Perfect play call by Michigan State. Just not well executed because of the physicality of Wake Forest quarterback Jamie Newman.
He's got 72 rushing yards already. Xavier Henderson, the sophomore out of Ohio, one of the top cornerbacks in the state coming out of high school, is down. Of course, college football with its 150th anniversary. Let's take it back to 1928 at Old Yankee Stadium. Notre Dame taking on Army, and this, of course, is the famous Win One for the Gipper halftime speech made by Newt Rockne in reference to the Fighting Irish All-American George Giff, who had passed away 8 years earlier at the age of 25. Notre Dame went on to upset Army 12-6 in that contest. Notre Dame and Army have played several games, including one here at New Yankee Stadium, in front of one of the biggest crowds that New Yankee Stadium has seen in the 17 college football games that have been played. Cade Carney, short gain, second down, running into Raekwon Williams.
Getting a little feisty out here. I'd say it started in the first quarter. You know, you go a long time without playing a football game. These guys are ready to play some football. It's been a physical contest, both up front and outside of the skill positions.
Newman off the back foot. He's got Jack Frudenthal. And the captain and senior takes it home for a touchdown. But Jamie Newman, standing in the pocket, took the hit from Raekwon Williams, the two-time All-Big Ten selection at defensive lineman, and put it on a dime for Jack Frudenthal, who has been a clutch tight end in big moments since Newman first took over as the starting quarterback a couple of seasons ago. Skiba adds the extra point, and Wake Forest jumps back out in front. We've already had four lead changes here in the first half of the New Era Pinstripe Bowl.
Well, you mentioned Jack Frudenthal, the tight end. He's lined up He's lined up right here, and he's got this middle linebacker here in a one-on-one situation. Joe Bocci, the normal linebacker, he is not out. Tight ends making an impact in this game right down the middle. Dave Clawson said to us yesterday, look for this matchup. If they want to play us a certain way, we're going to run our tight end right down the middle for a huge play. And Jamie Newman just staring down the gun barrel, taking a major hit. That's a penalty in the NFL. This is college football. These quarterbacks take a hit, but that is a great job of staying in there strong. And Jack Freudenthal, the tight end, the former walk-on, the captain. These tight ends, I love it. I love it tonight. Tight end football, Adam.
Well, Freudenthal, he was nominated last year for the Burlsworth Trophy, the top player who began his career as a walk-on. Kenny Willekes, in fact, of Michigan State, won that award this year. What a great story Jack Freudenthal is, playing in his 51st and final collegiate game. That's his fifth touchdown of the year. Had that huge game against North Carolina State with three scores. Had a game-winning touchdown against NC State a couple of years ago.
And what's your reward? Go cover,
yeah, go kickoff. Cover the kickoff. Yeah. There's Trenton Gillison, who's been impactful already today. He takes it out across the 25-yard line. Well, it's college football playoff eve. It's finally here. Four incredible programs, four quarterbacks that we've been tracking all season long, and it comes down to the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl with number one LSU and number four Oklahoma, and the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl, number two Ohio State, and number three Clemson. Starting up on ESPN, coverage all day long, Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl at 4 Eastern. It's also available on the ESPN app. What excites you about the two matchups tomorrow, Manny?
Well, I'm looking at that Ohio State defense. My alma mater, Boston College, just hired Jeff Hafley at Ohio State.
Yeah.
He's their defensive coordinator. I'd like to see that matchup and what he can do against Travis Etienne.
Jalen Naylor, the intended target, with a couple of defenders, including Esan Bassey, around him. Second down.
Well, this is an aggressive play call. They're saying, hey, we want to come out and take a shot. It's not really there. It's good coverage by Bassey. Henderson doesn't take the bait. But sometimes just sending the message. A lot of play callers will say, you know what, we're going to take at least one shot a quarter just to loosen them up.
Amari Henderson, the opposite corner, who's second in the ACC with four interceptions this year. One of the most experienced players on this entire roster, is having that right foot, right ankle checked out by the training staff. You know, we just mentioned the experience of Amari Henderson and a lot of these guys. You see Dave Clawson out there checking on Amari Henderson, who's playing in his 46th career game. That seems to be a major trend for Wake Forest. When we've gotten a chance to dive through a little bit of the Wake Forest program, this is a developmental program.
For sure. Dave Clawson's done an excellent job. And his theory, his philosophy is our freshmen don't need to be better than the other freshmen in the ACC. However, our juniors and seniors need to be better than their juniors and seniors. So we'll take 2- and 3-star recruits and develop them. And that's something that a lot of programs aren't able to do. Dave Clawson's done a nice job of that. If I could say one other thing just real quick, Adam, I love what Dave Clawson does with the whole person here. The student athlete at Wake Forest, they get an experience that I don't think a lot of Power 5 student athletes get. He does a great job developing them as young men as well.
Jalen Naylor on the sweep. It's kind of a cool day, too. Remember, this is Dave Clawson's kind of birthplace as a head coach. He started his career here in the Bronx, not too far away, over at Jack Coffee Field as a head coach of Fordham.
Yeah, he talked about those days at Fordham, and he said, what'd you learn at Fordham? He said, I learned everything about being a head coach. I really had no idea. I was a coordinator who turned head coach and had no idea. I made all my mistakes there, and now Wake Forest gets to reap the benefits of what was developed here in New York City years ago.
31 years of age when he got named the head coach at Fordham.
I got a little trivia for you, Adam.
Hit me.
Dave Clawson went to Williams College. Who else went to Williams College that might know a little something about this stadium?
Cody White makes the grab. Good gain for a first down. I actually do know this. George Steinbrenner.
Hey.
George and Hal Steinbrenner were both Williams College alums in Massachusetts.
Very good. I'm impressed, Adam.
That's a great question, strong. Man. That was a great question.
NESCAC school.
Approaching 5 minutes to play here in the first half. Fresh set of downs for Lewerke and Michigan State.
You see a lot of audibling by Lewerke. That's what you get with a senior quarterback who runs a pro-style offense.
Handed off here, checking to the run play with Collins. Grabs 2 yards to the 40. There is the George Steinbrenner mural, the boss. Late boss passed away 9 years ago. First decade in almost a century that the Yankees did not win a World Series. Obviously, the 27 titles for the Yankees, the most in Major League Baseball history.
And a lot of America is totally fine with that.
I feel like a lot of this booth might be okay with that.
Yeah, we're okay with that. We're okay with that.
On second down, Lewerke close to the sticks. It's grabbed by Trey Mosley, the true freshman. He's got the ball at the 32 for a first down. Cart.
Hey, every year he plans an off-season project, Dave Kloss, and he does a deep dive ranging from specific aspects of the game to player and mental, physical enhancements, and he researches it hard. And that thinking was built at Fordham when he was a 31-year-old head coach. First year, he took over at Fordham, 0-11. Year four, 10 wins. This guy can coach.
He's done the same thing at Wake Forest. Trevion Redd brings down Elijah Collins at the 25-yard line. Remember that this is a Wake Forest team that's seeking its first 9-win season in 12 years. They've never been to a bowl game 4 consecutive years until this year. Interesting to see how Dave Clawson and Mark D'Antonio match up as two head coaches kind of crossing each other in terms of trajectory of their programs for the time being. You saw Max Rosenthal on the deck, the fullback for Michigan State. He's getting checked out. So while we have a moment, we'll remind you that tomorrow on ABC and the ESPN app, go to Orlando at noon Eastern for the Camping World Bowl. First meeting ever between number 15 Notre Dame and Iowa State. Bob Wischusen, Dan Orlovsky, Allison Williams will have the call on ABC. Tim Hasselbeck will have the call on ESPN Radio as well. It's also streaming on the ESPN app. Talking about Notre Dame, this is the tie between Fordham and Notre Dame. The 7 blocks of granite, that incredible offensive line that played for Jim Crowley and future Notre Dame head coach Frank Leahy. Vince Lombardi was one of those 7 blocks of granite. Incredible offensive line for Fordham, and the Michigan State players got a chance to check that out. There's Max Rosenthal, a key cog for this Michigan State offense with a lot of tight ends hurt right now. They don't really have a true fullback except for Rosenthal.
Yeah, and fullback is an extension of the offensive line that you were just talking about, and Max Rosenthal has stepped up in that pass protection role. I see his hometown there, Winnetka, Illinois. Christmas time, all I can think about is that Home Alone movie, but his teammates talked about him in such positive light. Max Rosenthal coming through in pass pro.
You see all of the notable injuries this season. Cole Chewins, who was supposed to be their left tackle, didn't even get a chance to play this year. They used 7 different left tackles this season. Injuries at key positions throughout, especially on offense. Elijah Collins on the misdirection, unable to get away. Isang Bassi finishing him off after Deion Bergen Jr. had some of the penetration for Wake's defense.
Well, it's a good looking design pre-snap with the action left, but Isang Bassi not fooled at all. We mentioned Michigan State's kind of the TFL tackle for lost team, but Wake Forest, nice job on that play. Sets up a 3rd and long. Let's see what Michigan State can do with this right here.
Lewerke past the sticks. He's got Jalen Naylor for a first down inside the 20. Into the red zone go the Spartans. Trey Rucker on the stop.
Well, really nice job by Lewerke catching the snap, and the snap was a little low and left. It was a little off, a 13-yard gain right up the middle. They ran crossing routes, which is good versus man coverage, but that was zone coverage that Wake Forest disguised and gave to him. And so basically, Lewerke does a nice job of sort of overcoming a bad situation.
Yeah, they only rushed 3. There were 8 back in coverage for Wake on that play. Nowhere to go for Anthony Williams. Got hammered by Trevion Redd. He's the rover in place of Luke Masterson over the last 6 games.
Yeah, and losing Masterson is huge, but Trey Redd steps up. He comes right outside. you know, the New England Patriots say, set the edge, and that's called setting the edge, Trey Redd. Another tackle for loss. That's the fourth one today. That one lost another 4 yards. I know we're not calling it the red zone because you're outside the 20-yard line, but in my mind, this is the red zone, and Wake Forest is stepping up.
Lewerke gets rid of it to Darryl Stewart. Stewart is going to have to run out of bounds, being chased out by Jaquez Williams.
And again, that was one of those plays where technically, yes, it's a pass play. If you're just watching at home, that's a pass play.
Extension of the run, though, right?
But that is really just a running play. The offensive line, they're blocking the run, and all those other receivers out there, they're just blocking like it's a running play. Very high percentage completion pass. Wake Forest is in kind of a bend but don't break defense here, trying to keep him out of the end zone.
Lewerke pumps, and down he goes. It's Boogie Basham in the backfield. Now second in the ACC with 11 sacks.
Well, he doesn't just beat him like one-on-one. It's a stunt inside, and he slides right inside. He comes from outside back inside. Boogie Basham, we mentioned the pass rush ability on the outside. He's kind of a lean guy, but right up the middle, Lewerke had no chance.
I'm surprised Wake Forest isn't calling a timeout. They've got all three to work with. It's a 44-yard attempt for Coughlin, and he is able to deliver. It has not been a great year overall for Coughlin, but he puts it home inside the left upright.
Well, this is a big kick, and we mentioned Mark D'Antonio was talking about, hey, I've got confidence in Coughlin. He's a guy I can count on in clutch situations. And he said, maybe more importantly than my confidence, he's got confidence in himself. And it's a big kick right before the end of the half here for Michigan State.
49 seconds until we hit the halftime break. And coming up on the Mercedes-Benz Halftime Report, Kevin DeGondi, Jonathan Vilma, Mark Sanchez, they're in Glendale as we speak. They're going to break it down. Trevor Lawrence against Chase Young, and some Sooner suspensions as well for Oklahoma as they prepare for LSU. My guys will have all of the updates necessary, and they'll preview both playoff games as we are one day away. Well, Wake Forest did not use a timeout. Some time did come off the clock. They still have all three timeouts and 49 seconds left. Go with the short pooch kick. Kenneth Walker will get wrapped up just past the 30-yard line. Well, this season, for every field goal and extra point made by participating universities, Allstate will make a contribution to the university's general scholarship fund. Thank you, Allstate. That is not a goalpost, by the way. That is the right field foul pole.
It's a fake goalpost, and that was a fake Allstate read. You know, I was looking for Pat McAfee.
I missed it. I'm not going to be able to deliver it the way our boy Pat.
That was kind of corporate by you.
That was corporate. Well, he's the one that achieved the sponsor for Cheez-It this year.
All right, let's see what Jamie Newman can do. Two-minute drive. He's been good at two-minute drives.
And a little surprised. They could have saved about 30, 35 seconds had they called the timeout before the field goal, but 43 ticks to go from the 31. Jamie Newman's going to run it. And he will get past the sticks or not. No, they're going to mark him at the 40. So now the clock continues to move. Raekwon Williams came from behind and made the stop. Again, they're not using a timeout here. Newman stepping up, looking for Freudenthal, overthrown. Trey Person, the safety, had the coverage.
Yeah, I'm really surprised they didn't use a timeout right there. And it's not so much just about the clock. The whole play just kind of seemed rushed and hurried. They try to get Freudenthal back again down the middle. Michigan State was ready for it that time. I'd be surprised if they fall for it twice in the same game, but again, not using your timeouts is sort of a head scratcher here.
We'll run the football with Carney. He'll get the first down. Gonna truck two defenders and take it out to the 48-yard line. Shakur Brown was worse for the wear as big Cade Carney pounded it ahead.
And we talked about this being a physical game. We talked about Cade Carney missing in action in some of the earlier games. I mean, this is Big Ten football now. This is Michigan State. This is a physical football team. And Cade Carney says, hey, that's how we play in the ACC as well. If I was a secondary guy, I used to work with this guy, Charles Woodson.
Oh, I've heard of him.
Every time there was a big, like a Leonard Fournette type back trying to blow up a defensive back, he would turn and look at me and he'd say, see that right there? That right there is why I retired. I've had enough of that. And see Wood, I mean, Charles Woodson, he was a great tackler also, but I would not want to tackle a guy like Cade Carney.
He knows this Michigan State program well. Of course, the former Wolverine and some battles with the Spartans.
Wake Forest is kind of in a Hail Mary position here. And Michigan State takes
Michigan
the timeout.
Michigan calls their first time out of the half.
That's called a Polaroid.
Got a shot of what the offense puts out there?
Take a quick picture and get a look at what their formation is going to be. And typically in this kind of a situation, you call it an end of game play. Your last three is what they call it. And so you line up in the Hail Mary formation, and you maybe have your first play is going to be an out route. Maybe you get a timeout, or maybe you get it where you can get down the middle and spike it and take a shot for a Hail Mary.
Coming up next, a couple more bowl games on our quadruple header Friday. Old Big 12 rivals, the Cowboys and the Aggies, not too far away from College Station. They're at Houston for that one in the Academy Sports and Outdoors Texas Bowl, and then Air Force and Washington State. Cheez-It Bowl, 10-15 out in Phoenix. About 25 yards or so to get into Nick Skiba's field goal range. He's one of the best kickers in the country. This may be a free play, but they're going to rule it dead first. And Jamie Newman saying, hey, let me run the play here. But it was whistled dead. Dave Clausen's out on the field arguing that as well. They'll get the 5 yards, but they wanted to run a free play.
Yeah, Dave Clausen's right. I think this is a mistake by the official here. He should not have whistled this play dead.
Again, if it's unabated to the quarterback, if the quarterback's in danger, fine. But there was no danger on that play.
Offside by number 96 of the defense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still first down.
Jacob Panasha got called for it in the neutral zone.
Yeah,
you could have called it on him or Naquan Jones, but this isn't unabated to the quarterback, and
the
offenses want to run the play.
You know, in the official's defense, and maybe he's correct here, if the left tackle moves before the ball is snapped, then yes, you blow the whistle, penalty on the defense.
I mean, it might be a moot point with the time the way it is anyway. Newman will get this play off. He's got to hurry as time continues to wind down. Launches it for Frudenthal. Naquan Jones was bearing down on Newman and hit him a little low. And Newman is not limping by any means, but certainly walking a little bit more gingerly.
Yeah, those don't feel good. And I actually thought if he gave Frudenthal a chance, that's just an awkward hit to take. But if he gave Frudenthal a chance, I think the height advantage was there. Frudenthal's at every bit of 6'3". Wake Forest is going to cut their losses and go into halftime with two timeouts to waste, but still a pretty good first half. I mean, I didn't love the 2-minute drive there, but four lead changes, great football, great offense, fun to watch.
And the timeout questions for Dave Clausen, a little interesting there. 1-point lead for Wake Forest. Mercedes-Benz halftime report coming up with Kevin, Jonathan, and Mark.
Welcome back to Capital One Bowl Mania.
You're watching the 10th New Era Pinstripe Bowl, all part of Capital One Bowl Mania. One of the five boroughs of New York City saw four lead changes in a first-time meeting between Michigan State and Wake Forest. Brian Lewerke with a rushing touchdown in his 38th and final Michigan State start. Jamie Newman was equally impressive. He had three TDs in that opening half of play. Michigan State in a bowl game for the 12th time in 13 years under Mark D'Antonio, as Wake Forest is in a bowl game for the fourth consecutive time, for the first time under Dave Clausen, trying to get 9 wins. Adam Amin, Matt Hasselbeck, Paul Carcaterra, and a woman as well here from Yankee Stadium. Impressive stuff both sides. Back and forth opening first half.
Yeah, really exciting game. I mean, I think this whole bowl experience has been really fun for everybody, a fun week. And the game has matched that. You know, you mentioned the four lead changes, exciting offense, both quarterbacks playing well, and a defensive touchdown, a big man touchdown at that, which is always a good time.
That's the perfect transition into our clutch delivery. It's brought to us by Chipotle. The Panashuk boys, suburban Chicago, stand up right here. Jacob gets his hand up, goes up. Noah Harvey's back, and there's Mike Panashuk in his 51st and final game, taking it home for the big man score. Let's talk QBs.
Yeah, well, it was a tight end game for these quarterbacks right down the middle. First it was Lewerke, Michigan State, but then Jake Frudenthal, Jamie Newman found him. He found three different guys for touchdowns in the first half, really spreading the ball around. We mentioned the fast tempo. The ball's getting spread around. It's getting dealt. Both quarterbacks have kind of cut up these defenses like surgeons. We saw the tight end. We saw the tip pass touchdown that was scored on defense by Michigan State. Other than that, it's been a clean game offensively for both quarterbacks.
Michigan State will get the ball to start the second half. Jalen Naylor back to return along with Anthony Williams. The All-American kicker Nick Skiba out of Clover, South Carolina will boot it away. One of the upmen is going to grab it here for Michigan State. Take it across the 20-yard line and out across the 25. Looks like Maverick Hansen made the grab as we check in with Paul Carpenter.
Matt, you mentioned the quarterback play. Well, I just spoke to Mark D'Antonio, the Michigan State head coach. He thinks Brian Lewerke has opportunities to hit downfield with his wide receivers on the outside, but to establish that, you got to get the run game going, and that's an area of concern after the first half. Defensively, two things. They have to stop Jamie Newman, Wake Forest quarterback. He rushed for 87 yards in that first half, and then blown coverages in the middle of the field have haunted the Spartans.
That's exactly what Dave Clawson was hoping for, that big play to Frudenthal. A perfect example of that, Carr. Great stuff. Lewerke to throw on the first play of the half and underthrew it, trying to find Julian Barnett.
Yeah, that's coming out rusty and stiff out of halftime. As a quarterback, you got to make sure you're ready to go from the first play. That's a ball on the right hash, throwing a comeback all the way to the left side of the field. I know it's a long throw, but Lewerke's got that throw in his game. He just came out stiff. Whatever he did at halftime did not get him ready for the first play of the second half. That's a missed opportunity.
Off to Collins, slipping ahead to the 31-yard line. Brian Lewerke, originally from Phoenix, is where he went to high school, but a Tacoma kid growing up, big Seahawks fan, was a big fan of Matt Hasselbeck growing up as well. Had the relationship with Kirk Cousins when he first came to Michigan State for a visit. He and Kirk text once in a while. Obviously, Kirk's very busy in his NFL career, but maintain that relationship, and that's been very key for the Lewerke's growth.
Yeah, he talked about the relationship with Kirk Cousins and really a lot of quarterback tradition here at Michigan State. A lot of good players have come through this program. He also mentioned he was a Mariners fan and didn't really care too much about playing at Yankee Stadium.
Yeah, absolutely. Good connection to Trenton Gillison, who's had two big grabs today. This one for a first down to the 45. Carr?
Well, yesterday when Brian Lewerke walked into the meeting, saw Matt Hasselbeck. He had his jersey when he was a kid. He said he idolized you, Matt, when he was living in Washington. And I think he mentioned his grandfather, like, putting your blinds on.
That is cold-blooded as Kobe White takes it to midfield.
You know what? These college players are getting younger and younger. I'm like, oh, you mean your daddy? No, my granddad. I'm like, okay.
Oh, okay, sure. Thanks for that, buddy.
It is really cool to come, to have the opportunity to call these college games this year, you know, get to meet these kids, get to meet these coaches. You know, I mentioned earlier about our relationship with Dave Clawson and all the things that he does to develop kind of the whole person. And then earlier we talked to, you know, Michigan State. We talked about Josh Butler and what Mark D'Antonio has meant to them. Both Clawson and D'Antonio have done a nice job with both these programs in that regard.
Borky trying to hustle forward. Not much there as Deion Bergen is there for the stop. It's interesting to see where these programs are. Michigan State was in the Cotton Bowl in the playoff just four seasons ago. They've gone 26-24 since then. Obviously some restlessness, but Mark D'Antonio signed that Spartan for Life contract. And they've had seasons like this and have quickly turned things around. That's the hope for Michigan State going forward.
And they were off to a fast start. You know, they started out 4-1, and then they hit teams like Ohio State and Wisconsin, and you know, they can get it back on track. This is a statement game for them in recruiting, you know, for everything. This is the only game on right now. Converting on plays like this on this third down, it's going to be important if they're going to try to get a win today.
Collins got stopped about a yard shy by Amari Henderson. Fourth down and one in plus territory, Matt.
And I'm thinking they're going for it. You know, I'm surprised they're even hesitating. This is a team that, you know, we mentioned since from 2013 to 2015, they were 36-5. They're a team like a powerhouse team, a top four type team. And so I expect to see a little bit more attitude. I'm surprised they waited so long to just wonder if you're going to go for it in fourth and 6 inches.
Fourth and short, they're lining up in the gun with Lewerke. Little option play, trying to drive the legs forward. The ball came out loose, but the line judge from the near side says he was down and seemingly past the sticks. And that's the case, it's a first down. Smenda and Williams charging in on it.
Yeah, and it's actually a pretty good play defensively. But again, it's just fourth and 6 inches. So, you know, even if you do make a nice play, Williams makes the play there. It's just fourth and 6 inches. And again, sometimes it's just a statement by your head coach and by your play caller, how long you decide if you're gonna trust your guys and go for it in a fourth and short situation.
So Brad Salem, the first year play caller, 10th year on staff at Michigan State. Elijah Collins slips free. Outrunning Henderson. Pushed out of bounds. Big gainer for the redshirt freshman from Detroit. 31 yards.
Huge gain, and I got to believe it's just right off the heels of that fourth down conversion. What that can do for your offensive line. The confidence. You know, the defense is taught, hey, win third down, get off the field. Win third down, get off the field. So when you convert on fourth down, you know, it's really just a kick in the stomach. And you see now the momentum that Michigan State has again in the red zone instead of possibly punting two plays ago.
Right back to Collins. Two of his better runs of the day back to back. Boogie Basham on the stop at the 10-yard line. He only had 27 yards on his first dozen carries before he busted open that 31-yarder.
And you see Wake Forest feels it. They brought the corner blitz there. From the offense's left side, they're saying, hey, we are going to fill all the gaps here. We are not going to let you run this in. Priority number one is stopping the run. Once you stop the run, you got to be ready for some play action pass.
Play fake. Dumps it off. Cody White. Trying to hit the pylon. He's in. Touchdown Spartans, and they jump back out in front. The fifth lead change of the Pinstripe Bowl.
That's a big drive, and I think offensive coordinator Brad Salem saw what I saw. They were biting on the run. He comes back with the play action, a naked bootleg. Clearly a touchdown. The official, the referee on this side, lost his footing and he went to the ground. That's why the hesitation on the touchdown call, but perfect play call by Brad Salem. Well executed by Michigan State, all set up by that fourth down conversion.
Brad Salem hadn't called plays since he was a head coach at Division II Augustana in South Dakota 10 years ago. They went for it on fourth down and converted, and it ends in a touchdown to Cody White. The offense of the Spartans trying to get it done. National championship in New Orleans on January the 13th. The playoffs begin tomorrow. Of course, Michigan State will see Ohio State next season. They'll have to go on the road this year. They ran into that buzzsaw of Ohio State that started that tough stretch for him this year. Meanwhile, Wake Forest got blitzed by Clemson, although you could say that for a lot of teams, especially in the second half of the year. They'll host Clemson next season in ACC play. Michigan State will host Ohio State. Kenneth Walker from the 10. Shifting his way out across the 35-yard line.
Well, Adam, let's take a look at who's making smart decisions. Brought to you by NerdWallet. I mentioned the smart decision, 4th and 6 inches. Go for it. Make it a confidence builder for your offensive line. The very next play, Elijah Collins rips off a big run, puts him right into the red zone. They're realizing that they got to stop the run. They come with a naked bootleg at the perfect time. Cody White on the bootleg. Brian Lewerke makes it look easy. Speaking of Nerd Wallet, Brian Lewerke, an econ major, got to go to the New York Stock Exchange yesterday.
Yep.
Said it was the highlight of his trip.
Underneath throw to Stephen Claude for about 9 on the play. That was one of the cool moments. You had to go to the Stock Exchange and ring the bell. That's pretty awesome.
Well, I thought it was awesome. Dave Clawson said over half of his team had never even been to New York City.
Yeah.
Now they get to come here and they get a first class visit, trip, chaperone, you know, all the cool stuff.
Yeah.
You know, really cool that these kids get this opportunity. Having played in bowl games, it is a really nice thing you get to do. And, you know, obviously for the program, you get to stack all these extra practices. It's like an extra spring football for your program.
Newman underthrown to Kendall Hinton, who has one of the touchdown grabs today.
And it's really interesting. Like, what's the highlight of your bowl week? I get to go to the New York Stock Exchange.
Very Nerd Wallet thing to say. Well, but, hey, you respect it, man. I respect it. These kids are 22 years old, 23 years old, thinking about their futures. You mentioned it. Lewerke's an econ major. Some of the captains, along with the coaches, got to go.
And as you mentioned, the stock market was way up.
105, the Dow Jones yesterday up 105. Incomplete for Hinton. Jamie Newman, all he can do is smile. Third down and 10 coming up for Dave Clawson's offense.
It's a smile, but it's not really a smile. It's like, come on, man, let's go.
Yeah.
Like, this is the time to step up. 5 lead changes. Michigan State just went up. It's our turn to answer the bell.
I see what you did there. Newman with protection. Couple of flags are thrown. One from the offensive backfield and one from the defensive. Kendall Hinton, Stephen Claude made the grab. We'll have to check both of these markers here.
Jamie Newman went right back to his guy, Kendall Hinton. I used to do that too. After a wide receiver would drop a pass, I'd go right back to him. But I think it might have been Claude.
Yeah, it was Claude. That was my fault.
Personal foul. Chop block number 79 and number 36 of the defense. It's a 15-yard penalty and still third down.
Well, that's the
second chop block, right?
Yeah, and, you know, uncharacteristic. You know, when I think of the Dave Clawson team, I think of a team that doesn't get penalized very often. You know, that's just an accidental type thing that happens there.
It's a lot of it is timing, it feels like, right? You can't go high or low on a guy who's already engaged.
You can't
go low on a guy who's already engaged.
Exactly. You can't go low on a guy that's already engaged. And, you know, you could maybe argue that guy wasn't already engaged there. But in an effort for player health and safety, I think they err on the side of caution with that penalty flag.
Sets him back to third down and a quarter of the field. McGinn and Carney were tagged on that last penalty.
Third and 25 is not where you want to be as a play caller.
And now the play clock's winding all the way down, and the flag was thrown.
You know what's worse than third and 25?
Is it third and 30?
By number 12 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still third down.
It's third and 30. That's the second time tonight that you've been accurate.
It's probably the only two times I've been accurate, in all honesty. But so now Jamie Newman's lining it up. Go ahead and get the signals once again.
These signalers are elite.
They're on top of it.
They're working. I've been a backup quarterback where I've not been playing in the game, and your job as a signaler is just as important as the guys on the field sometimes.
Let's see if Newman can take a shot. He's got plenty of time, but now he's going to take off and run. Weave his way out to the 40-yard line, so Wake Forest will have to punt it away. Don't forget that Monday we've got the Capital One Orange Bowl. Kyle Trask going to take over early in the season for Felipe Franks, taking on one of the elite quarterbacks. You got to see him if you're a Wake Forest or ACC fan. Bryce Perkins of Virginia, number 9, number 24. Their first Orange Bowl for the Cavaliers at Hard Rock Stadium in Miami.
Yeah, I like watching Bryce Perkins play. And, you know, I think maybe the only thing I like more than watching him play, his post-game interviews were awesome.
He's one of the truly poised young men we've seen. Kid who was at Arizona State and transferred in, had that brutal neck injury that could have ended his career and bounced back to become one of the elite QBs in the ACC. Michigan State's got a six-point lead and the football on what is a beautiful night, a mild night in late December here in the Bronx.
The New Era Pinstripe Bowl, brought to you by Capital One. What's in your wallet? And Taco Bell's Roll Chicken Tacos Party Packs.
Both of these teams got to experience the sights and sounds of Manhattan. Dave Clawson, like you mentioned, Matt, said that more than half of his players had never been to New York City. But obviously, this is great, too. You know, very good educational institution. Nathan O. Hatch is the 13th president of Wake Forest. And during his press conference, he was saying 65% of Wake alumni are within driving distance to New York City. So actually got a decent amount of Wake fans that made the trip. Michigan State fans as well. Great trip here in the month of December around Christmas time. Brian Mawerke starts this series with a quick strike to his tight end, Parks Gissinger. First career catch for the redshirt freshman from Los Angeles.
In a high completion percentage offense is Michigan State. You know, they like to get the drive started. They like to throw the ball on first down. They like to get completions. That's their eighth first down pass attempt. You know, for a team that's trying to establish the run, because they've struggled running the ball a little bit.
Right.
You know, we mentioned they've got three freshman running backs. And, you know, they've started seven left tackles.
Yep.
You know, it's things like that. You can use that short passing game as an extension of your running game just to get it going.
This was Mark D'Antonio's worst rushing offense in terms of yards per game. Only 123 rushing yards per game, the lowest in the 13 years under Mark D'Antonio. Here's a jet sweep for Anthony Williams, trying to get the speedster on the sideline, and he gets wrapped up shy of the sticks. Ryan Smendo was there, so was Ja'Cory Johns.
Yeah, Wake Forest was ready for it this time. Schmenda, you know, it's a jet sweep, but it's a jet sweep with a lead blocker. That time it was Brandon Wright, the big freshman. He's a bigger tailback type guy, but he was the lead blocker. So, yes, it's a jet sweep, but these linebackers are taught. Look for the uncovered lineman, look for the fullback, and chase those guys. You'll find the football.
So they went for it on fourth down and short in plus territory, but here, just shy of the 38-yard line, they'll punt it away on fourth down. Fourth, three and out for the Spartans, and Hartbarger with a good boomer to get it inside the 20-yard line. This is my favorite promo of the night. Let's take a look at who's showing up, presented by Peloton. Matt Hasselbeck showed up at his Peloton lab with the
Peloton
birthday girl, Sarah Hasselbeck.
That's right. Peloton kicked my butt today, and Kendall Hinton kicked the defense's butt in the first quarter, and Jamie Newman spread it around. That was his first touchdown pass. This was another nice back shoulder touchdown pass. And then he hits the tight end right down the middle, solving the riddle. It was Jack Frudenthal for the next one. Jamie Newman really came out of nowhere 2 years ago with his first start against NC State. Played really good football. He played good football tonight as well.
Run it with Kenneth Walker here for a couple of yards. Again, shout out one more time, Sarah Hasselbeck.
Happy birthday. I'll just tell you, it was my wife's birthday today. We're here at the Pinstripe Bowl, and our hotel was right around the corner from the Peloton Studios. You know, the Peloton,
sure,
exercise bike, obviously. We have one at home. We use it religiously. And she said, hey, you want to get up really early with our daughter and go to a Peloton?
Which sounds really appealing when you put it that way.
I was into it until I found out it was a 45-minute.
Newman with a strike past the sticks. That's good enough for a first down to Ja'Cory Roberson, the redshirt sophomore. Well, there is an injured Spartan down on the field. Looks like Jacob Slade. Nope, I beg your pardon. That is Jacob Panashuk, a junior out of Roselle, Illinois. He's already had a big tip today in this game, leading to a pick six.
Let's bring the energy and the focus, all right? Energy and focus, and let's get better today.
When you guys flying around, we got to be physical.
Love the physicality and competitiveness. Okay, let's channel that in to doing the right thing, taking care of one another. Everybody good with that?
Best thing is, I know about this football team, you're going to respond. I know you will. You'll do anything we ask you to. Anything we demand you to do it, I know you will.
Soon as on three. One, two, three. Soon.
All in on three. One, two, three. All
out on three. One, two, three.
All out.
All Access for the College Football Playoff Episode 1 streaming now on ESPN Plus. Worth the subscription alone. Kenneth Walker got a power ahead. Got back to the line of scrimmage. Kenny Willekes there on the stop. Banasik had to leave the field. His brother Jacob still out there. Send it to Walker on the sideline again. In space. And the Michigan State defense swarms him at the 29. Third down coming up for Wake Forest.
It's kind of weird to see Wake Forest go so slow.
Yeah. Well,
when I think of Wake Forest football, I think of the fastest tempo in college football. And I see them go slow. It almost takes them out of their rhythm.
The goal is about 90 a game. They average 82 plays per game. Low throw, incomplete, trying to find Roberson. That was the 49th play of the game for Wake Forest. In fact, Michigan State has run more plays than Wake in this game.
Yeah, which is really surprising, and you got to give Michigan State, Mark D'Antonio, some credit. You know, they do a nice job of kind of taking away your first option. Kendall Hinton had 70 catches coming into this game. He's got one tonight. Jamie Newman completes a high percentage of his passes usually. He's down well under 50%.
Maggio with the punt. Another good one inside the 20 for Sowers. It's the first man miss and will make it a positive return out to the 25-yard line. We talked about Mark D'Antonio. The last few years, ever since that Cotton Bowl playoff loss to Nick Saban in Alabama, the numbers have been great, 26-24 record. But reset me a little bit on what you got from Mark D'Antonio yesterday. He really put major value on this game because he knows what it can lead to.
Well, I really appreciated how much he cared for the 21 seniors on his team and what a game like this means to the program, but also what it means to these seniors. And I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're Nick Saban. I really don't care who you are. If you start seven different people at left tackle, yeah, and two true freshmen running backs and a redshirt freshman, it's going to be hard to have the kind of season you expect to have when the season starts.
Wide open man, Jalen Naylor, near side. Able to corral it, shy of midfield. They'll spot him right near the 44.
And this is close. This is a really close one right here. This is a huge play. Could have been more, but Naylor, you know, securing that catch was everything. You know, getting back to D'Antonio yesterday, just talking about the seniors and the senior leadership.
Yeah.
Talking to guys like Kenny Willekes and talking to Ryan Lewerke, just really get the sense that these guys understand that the game like this is bigger than just about them. It's Cody about the White. Michigan State program in general.
Sorry, Matt. Cody White picks up the first down. It's easy to see both sides of the equation. Oh, well, they haven't had a whole lot of success as of late, but you know, before that, they went to the playoff. How do you evaluate this team? They went 7-6 in 2012, and that included that bowl win in the Buffalo Wild Wings Bowl, and then they won those 36 games over the next 3 years. That's what a lot of coaches will tell you. The value of these bowl games is exponentially bigger and bigger with all those practices that you get. They work it to Anthony Williams here. Another first down near the 30-yard line.
Yeah, and I also think the Big Ten was strong this year.
Yeah, great point.
I mean, obviously Ohio State, Wisconsin, Michigan, but Minnesota was a good team this year. Penn State's a good team. I think getting a win here tonight for Michigan State would be huge for this program, especially the kind of year that they have. Getting like 7-6, just
it sounds better, it feels better than 6-7.
Exactly.
It just does, and any coach will tell you that.
And any recruit will tell you that as well.
Yeah.
We had the early signing day. There's another signing day coming up. I just think that that's a factor here. You could sense it yesterday in our time, not only with the coaches, but also with the players. And senior leadership.
You know, I
can't say it enough. You know, just how impressed I was with the guys that I met on this football team.
Here's a reverse. Cody White. He can sling it. Little trickery, but incomplete. He had Larice Nelson streaking down the sideline. Cody won. White unable to connect. That's the third career pass for White.
And he's going to kick himself if he ever watches this film, because he's got Jalen Naylor wide open from the get-go. No one near him. Like, absolutely no one near him. He's out in center field all by himself.
Yeah, it was out of the 408 marker waiting for a ball.
Hey, missed opportunity there for Michigan State. Excellent play call. Just couldn't get it timed up from wide receiver to wide receiver.
Out of the empty set on third down. Lewerke intercepted off the hands of Collins. It's intercepted for Wake Forest by Smenda. He lost the ball and Bassey was there to recover it. It's Wake Forest football. A key mistake for Lewerke, and that's been his season. We've seen a ton of good, but at times some rough spots, in particular with the interceptions.
This has been Michigan State's season, story of their season. Missed opportunity to play before, and then tips and overthrows.
Gotta get those.
That was Schmenda on the interception. The trick play should have been a touchdown. Instead, they go with the check down, what you think is more conservative, leads to an interception. Again, no points for Michigan State. Man, that is a tough sequence, because the reverse pass was such a perfect play call. And then your quarterback thinking that you're doing the conservative thing, just checking it down, leads to an interception. That is tough.
First career pick for Schmenda. And now Jamie Newman back to work. Running it on first down. Takes it to the 25-yard line. Jamie Newman left the season finale at Syracuse in the second quarter as he was banged up with a leg injury. They gave him a couple of weeks off from practice. He was raring to go, chomping at the bit to get back at the helm of this offense. Sam Hartman did a nice job of filling in a couple of times for an injured Jamie Newman in relief. Had a start earlier this year against Louisville.
Yeah, I think Wake Forest does a nice job of developing quarterbacks. Jamie Newman obviously is a special player, but Sam Hartman, I like him as a player. When he's played, he's a very different style of quarterback. A little smaller, probably a little bit more accurate of a passer. Not the runner that Jamie Newman is, obviously.
As he carries up the first
the
down.
Entire huddle with him, Mark Bavaro style, on that third down run.
Solid Bavaro reference there as well.
But I really have been impressed with how they've developed, players at the quarterback position here.
Third 100-yard rushing game of the season. Boston College, Duke, and now Michigan State. That's for Jamie Newman. Jumping with the pass, Donovan Green kind of pushed off his defender. It ends up being an incomplete pass anyway. Paul, you can talk a little bit more about the development of Jamie Newman.
So impressed with this kid. I spoke to him this week, and Matt, you mentioned he's running around making plays like Cam Newton, but his favorite quarterback is Deshaun Watson. He worked with him at a camp, and Watson was around a ton of college kids. He was so impressed with his leadership, how vocal he was, and his attention to detail. It upped the ante this offseason for Jamie Newman, and the proof is in the pudding. This kid's a stud. Big time future.
Rolling right. Underneath throw, incomplete. Trying to find Donovan Green. Now, obviously, we were talking about recruiting and development and things like that. Tom Luganville, who does a fantastic job for us, especially on the recruiting trail, was texting with us earlier today, and he was saying, listen, if Jamie Newman, more people took notice of this guy, he would be in a bigger program, but he's going to play in the NFL for a long time. He would have been an All-American at maybe a more, I guess, a bigger school, for lack of a better term. Little back shoulder throw, and it is good for a reception near the 40-yard line. A.T. Perry with his fourth career grab for 29 yards.
Well, this is that same formation. Four receivers on one side. Give me an isolation on the other side. They go to the tall receiver. It ends up being a back shoulder throw. Again, these are the Sage Surratt plays that younger receivers are having to step up and run in his absence.
Newman in a collapsing pocket, just trying to hold on to the football. End up taking a loss on the play. That may take us to the end of the third quarter. Drew Beasley and Kenny Willekes off the edges were there to wrap up Newman.
Yeah, Jamie Newman was up over 100 yards rushing. I don't know if that goes against his average there, but
yeah, it does. He's under 100 now at 97.
But an impressive runner, a developing passer with a bright future. You know, and Dave Clawson just trusts him in these big situations, in these close games. He's done a nice job all year.
Hey, we showed up in New York City. We were hoping for a competitive game. It's a beautiful night at a great venue. 5 lead changes in the first ever meeting between Sparty and the Demon Deacons. Fourth quarter coming. Some contemplative moments before the start of the fourth quarter for the senior quarterback in his final Michigan State game, Brian Lewerke, his team up by 6.
Yeah, that's called stretching too, Adam. You might want to look into it.
My back's stiffening up a little bit, man.
Hey, this has been an awesome night.
Awesome.
Yankee Stadium is as advertised. If you haven't seen a game here, you got to do it. A football game, a hockey game, a baseball game,
yep.
Whatever. This is a really cool venue, and what an incredible night. Late December.
Yeah, awesome. Rangers have played here a couple of times in a week. They played the Devils and the Islanders here in the Stadium Series. Newman underneath. Oh, that was almost a pick for Thompson. That would have been a huge swing right there. Instead, third down and long coming up.
Well, Tyreek Thompson subbing in for Joe Bocci. He's now the man in the middle. He's a thumper. Great first and second down linebacker. He'll hit you. You know, I like to say to guys on defense, you got feet for hands, but I mean, it's harder than it looks at home, I got to tell you, but that's a nice play by the defender.
You mentioned it, Joe Bocci was declared ineligible after 8 starts this season for testing positive for what the Big Ten deemed a performance-enhancing substance. He is not with the team as he prepares for the next chapter of his career. They'll run it here with Carney on fourth and long. They work it to the 38. Still about 8 yards to go on fourth down, so they're going to keep the offense out of the field.
And this fast tempo is so impressive. Michigan State.
Yeah, I think they're forced to take a timeout, man.
Exactly.
So a little bit more time Michigan to think State about what to call on fourth and 8.
Media timeout.
The New Era Pinstripe Bowl. Brought to you by New Era. Visit us at neweracap.com and Coca-Cola. Share the magic this season with an ice-cold Coca-Cola. Enjoy the holidays. Enjoy Coca-Cola.
Michigan State players putting on a football camp for inner-city youth at Yankee Stadium. Again, the community service that teams do during these bowl games continues, and it should continue to be commended as well. Fourth down and 8 for Wake Forest inside the 40 of Michigan State. Newman, he's got one-on-one. Receiver with separation in Green, but it's incomplete. Josiah Scott had the coverage down the field, but a flag was thrown back at the 48-yard line.
A personal foul, hands to the face by number 79 of the offense. The penalty's declined. It's first down.
Sean McGinn on the penalty. That's declined. It's Michigan State football.
That's a disappointing penalty, but it's a great play call. You can tell they love this Donovan Green kid. They love his ability. They love his upside. Had an opportunity for it. This is a guy they got in the recruiting war with Notre Dame and Tennessee and South Carolina. He chose Wake Forest. He's got a bright future. That would have been a huge answer on fourth down, but Jamie Newman just didn't give him enough air on that. Completing only 42% of his passes tonight is Newman, and that's an area where I really feel like he needs to improve and develop as a passer. But he's got a bright future. He just needs to fine-tune some of those things. Can't miss the gimmies like that one.
Elijah Collins to start this Spartan drive, and he runs it for a first down out near midfield. Brian Lewerke with his team up by 6 going back to work. We talked about it. He was aware where his name is in the record books. One of the two that he pointed out to us immediately was the total offense mark. He wanted to pass Connor Cook. Sure enough, he's done that today. The most career total yards in Spartan history. He's got 19 completions. He's 9 shy of Kirk Cousins' mark for that all-time at MSU. Jalen Naylor got grabbed at the ankles by Trey Rucker, but a good gain on first down. Picks up 6.
Yeah, it's impressive, and Lewerke, smart guy, you know, real cerebral. He sat down in the meeting. It almost felt like we were talking to the offensive coordinator of the team when he first sat down. And, you know, I'm happy for him. You know, this is a kid that's had the ups and downs of the career. People have been tough on him because of the interceptions late in the season. But he's a 23-year-old kid with 12,000 passing yards. It's impressive.
Tyler Williams was in the neutral zone there.
Offsides by number 72 of the defense with contact. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still second down.
Let's check in with Paul Carcaterra down on the field.
Earlier in the game, we saw Trenton Gillison with a huge catch for over 40 yards. Well, number 88, the freshman, has been limping. He missed the last few series. He's on the field right now, guys, but there's no way he's 100%. He could barely run at full speed. And Max Rosendahl, their starting fullback, he's on crutches. He's done for the day.
Thanks for that, Paul. Anthony Williams, the speedster, slipping ahead. He'll pick up about 9 to the 30. So again, who did we just talk about? A tight end and a fullback tight end. When they're coming in, already two tight ends short. So this is a very thin position for Michigan State's offense now.
Yeah, it really is. And that's the thing. You got to kind of suck it up and fight through injuries sometimes as an injured player.
Working on the sneak, picks up the first down.
And that's what Gillison's doing. Again, the quarterback sneak, you know, the element of surprise, just getting up there with tempo. And Anthony Williams as well. Like, Gillison's toughing it out for guys like Anthony Williams to make some plays. Like, they've got some big playability guys in this football game. Just need some opportunities. Michigan State knocking on the door of the red zone here. They see these safeties really shallow. They're looking to the sideline for a new signal for the play. Tight end Gillison's coming in to block. They're going with a 7-man protection. They see something they like downfield.
He's got time. He's got a man. It's White. First down inside the 15-yard line. Now White limping a little bit after the play.
And that's really what they see. They just see a 4 across coverage, and they realize they're going to get free access outside. They take the comeback that they started this half with. Michigan State with another drive of 10 players or more, kind of methodically marching this football down the field. And the nice benefit of this, if you talk about complimentary football for Coach D'Antonio, his defense is on the bench,
yep,
resting against one of the fastest tempo offenses. They get to watch their offense go to work.
Lewerke on the rollout. Fires towards the back of the end zone for White, incomplete.
And I believe he might have been
past the line of scrimmage.
Absolutely.
We didn't see a flag thrown, but it looked like he threw the ball from about the 10. The line of scrimmage was the 11.
Well, he was rounding third base there.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it's actually the official on this side of the field that throws the flag. They go with the rollout. It's just a 1-2-3 read. He goes 1-2-3. No one's really open.
Looked like it was inside the 11. The ball and the body have to be past the line of scrimmage.
Yep.
An illegal forward pass by number 14 of the offense. He was beyond the line of scrimmage when he threw the ball. It's a 5-yard penalty and a loss of down. It's second down.
You said it. The field judge on the nearest side was the man who made the call. Dave Clawson was standing right next to the field judge. And that ends up being not only the loss of the down, but the loss of yardage as well.
And I got to tell you, from being on sidelines for many years, the art of working the officials by head coaches is very fascinating to me. You know, some guys are hard on the officials. Some guys kind of butter them up early in the game, talk to them like they're friends. Clearly, Dave Clawson on that, standing next to that official right there, had some sort of influence on that flag being thrown.
Cooper Castleberry in his final game as a football official here today.
The foul puts the ball at the 15-yard line. It's second down.
Congratulations on a great career, Cooper Castleberry.
And congratulations on a great name, too.
Awesome name. Solid. Official out of the Big 12 Conference. Lewerke fakes the jet sweep. Little shovel to Gillison, who's been very impactful today. But that ball may have come out loose, and sure enough, it did! Jaquez Williams coming up with a huge play for Wake Forest in a 6-point game.
I was just about to say, situational football, look at the score. You got to come away with 3 points here. And Jaquez Williams, who's in for Justin Strnad, comes up, steps up with a huge play for this Wake Forest defense. We mentioned that Gillison was not 100% healthy. He's trying to suck it up for his team, be tough. And unfortunately, a big play for Wake Forest. Jaquez Williams steps up. Can Jamie Newman and company do something with it?
was a poor takeaway team a season ago. This year, it was a huge emphasis for Lyle Hemphill, who took over as the defensive coordinator after four games in 2018. They've been much better this season, and they come up with a clutch turnover here.
Yeah, they've been a takeaway machine on defense. Came into this game 12th in the country. They've got two takeaways tonight, back-to-back possessions.
And now, as you said, Matt, trying to do something with it. They run for 9 yards with Kenneth Walker, who got hit hard by Josiah Scott.
Yeah, these true freshmen playing in this... I mean, to think these guys, some of these true freshmen, they were playing high school football last year on Friday night.
They're probably right now, this time last year, they're probably playing high school basketball.
It was kind of a late hit, actually. Yeah. In the NFL, that's going to be a flag.
Yeah, Willekes was on the hit.
I think in college, that's going to be a flag as well. It looks like he's grimacing about his shoulder.
Christian Beal-Smith was essentially the number two running back, but he was suspended late in the regular season. So Kenneth Walker stepped up in a big way. Really, Walker's been the number two guy most of the year, but it's a much thinner running back group late in the year than it was midway through. Kenny Willekes on the left, Kenneth Walker on the right. A little bit of a late collision. Willekes got hurt in the bowl game last year, the Red Box Bowl against Oregon. Actually suffered a broken fibula, had to rehab and recover, but he was ready to go for the 2019 season. Juxtaposition here in terms of experience, the senior and the redshirt freshman.
Yeah, you asked Kenny, he said, hey, did you have any doubts about or any second thoughts about playing in the bowl game this year? Some guys skipped this game. He said, no, what are you talking about? Never. That's not who I am. These guys voted me captain. I would never walk out on them. Time for him and his defense to dig in, get another stop.
Wake Forest with second and short after the Walker run. It's Cade Carney with a hole up the middle for a first down. It's an interesting thing to think about. It's become more of a discussion. More high-profile players who will have massive NFL futures are sitting out bowl games. And obviously, it's every individual's decision to do it. But it's really fun to see when you hear a guy like Willekes say, no, I'm a captain. I can't abandon my guys this late in my career.
Yeah, and I think every team's got their own DNA, their own personality. And this Michigan State team, kind of the personality of Kenny Willekes. I mean, he's a former walk-on turned Big Ten defensive lineman of the year.
Jamie Newman looking deep for Claude, and it's incomplete. A penalty flag thrown all the way back near the line of scrimmage, though. And it looked like Henderson took out one of the officials on the near side. Oh, no. That's the field judge. Hey,
and he committed to the incomplete
commit
call.
To it. I appreciate that from
offside,
Randy Smith.
The defense lined up in the neutral zone. It's a 5-yard penalty and replay first down.
Hey, props to you, Randy Smith, our field judge, who took the hit and still made the call.
Let's see what he's got here. Let's see if he's nimble. Pretty nimble. Yep. I would have liked to have seen a little more air time when he tries to jump up. I understand he's moving from his left to his right. Pretty athletic on the fall, though. I got to give him a little bit of credit. He stays in the game. Well done.
Part of this Big 12 crew. Hope you're all right down there, buddy. So the 5-yard penalty makes it first and five. Newman on the keep. Still churning the legs, and they'll take it to the 26. Second down coming up. Dowell and Thompson on the tackle.
And really for Wake Forest right now, I think you got to find a way to get Kendall Hinton involved. He's got only one catch tonight. You know, they missed Sage Surratt just a little bit. He caught over 1,000 yards worth of passes this season. Kendall Hinton stepped up, and there he is.
Right on cue, his second grab. The first one was the first Newman pass of the day for that 29-yard touchdown that gave Wake Forest the early lead.
Yeah, and let's not pretend let's not forget about what he was in the return game as well.
Yeah, he's been
very
bad.
He had a long return. He had the other one called back. I think two penalties on returns tonight. But Kendall Hinton, the former quarterback, if you could just get the ball in his hands, he could do something special with it.
Under pressure, Naquan Jones in the backfield to bring down Newman. First sack of the season for the Evanston, Illinois native.
Well, this is just, I mean, that's just like a man playing with boys just right through the middle there. That is just a really tough look. As an offensive lineman, that is not what you're looking for, but you said it, Adam. Number 93, Naquan Jones. They list him at 338. Usually when they list you at 338, you weigh a lot more than 338. That was a big hit.
Right back to Hinton. He gets that lost yardage back. and takes it to the 37, tackled by Dowell. Hinton had to step up huge, especially late in the year. He was banged up a little bit in the early part of the season, but remember, he had a game winner in the opener against Utah State, and with the Washington and Surratt injuries, he was their main target late in the year. Third down and 8. Newman stepping up, wrapped up by Willekes. The forward progress to the 38-yard line, and it's fourth down.
We mentioned Michigan State had to dig in on defense. That's the fourth drive in this fourth quarter. 0 points.
Yeah.
That's answering the bell when it's your turn to step on the field.
And Newman limping back towards the sideline, and what has been, as Matt aptly pointed out, a physical game between these two teams tonight.
And that's one of the things, and that's one of the reasons why I think Sam Hartman is so important to this program, because knowing that you have Sam Hartman as your backup quarterback, you can call these design runs.
That's another great punt by Maggio. Will it stick? It will! Sowers will grab it, though, smartly. What a heads-up play by the 60-year senior. Takes it out across the 25, but there is a penalty marker that gets thrown on the play. That was a dynamite punt. And then Sowards made an even better play on it, but now we got a flag. Where's Pat McAfee?
You know, I thought Pat was crazy, but the punt,
he's right.
It might be the most exciting play in football.
Oh, man.
An illegal block in the back by number 13 of the receiving team. The penalty is half the distance to the goal. And it's first down.
That hurts, though.
Hey, that is a heck of a punt, and that is good for the brand. And there's something called the fourth down army. That's specialists, snappers, holders, kickers, and yes, returners are part of the fourth down army. And this is a heck of a play by Brandon Sowards. Heads up play by the senior. Saved a lot of yardage there. Obviously, the penalty on the illegal block.
Yep. On Marcel Lewis.
Not ideal, not what you're looking for. Got to learn from those, got to get coached up. Something that coaches would always say that I always appreciated: I don't care if you make a mistake, just don't make the same mistake twice.
So now backed up to their own 10. The Spartans start this drive with a run from Collins. Slipped a couple tackles. Tyler Williams was in the backfield, but he was begging for a penalty flag, and the flag was thrown. It's against the Spartans. This could back them up even further.
Holding by number 76 of the offense. The penalty's half the distance to the goal, and it's still first down.
A.J. Arcuri, one of the 7 different left tackles that has been in that spot this year. They've started 4 different guys and have played 7. They got to a point where Matt Allen, who was their starting center at the beginning of the year and was potentially healthy and ready to go for this game, was basically their backup left tackle, because Devontae Dobbs, who had started against Rutgers, has already played 4 games as a true freshman, and they want to save his redshirt. First and 15. Off the play action. Lewerke gets rid of it. He's got a man, and it's Trey Mosley out across the 20 for a first down.
This is as big of a throw as you can make as a quarterback from your own end zone. Pressure coming, a blitz coming. You get the ball out early with anticipation. And I see it down there on the field, Paul. That ball was completed right in front of our guy, Kark.
Now Michigan State with that 6-point lead, approaching 7 minutes to play. Sets up at the 21-yard line. And off for Collins. Let's go down to Cart.
Yeah, that looked like Hasselbeck zipping it in. But keep an eye on Elijah Collins. Left ankle is taped. He was getting monitored by the training staff. He's a great story. Didn't even play football 4 years ago. Mark D'Antonio went to his high school, Detroit Jesuit, asked Pat Donnelly, the basketball coach, what position does he play in football? He said he doesn't. Well, he left saying he should. And 4 years later, he's in this big spot.
Been nursing that ankle issue since the Maryland game late in the season. He was questionable to come to the bowl game and play, but he has been productive. The number one running back in the state of Michigan out of high school after not even playing initially. Knocked down by Boogie Basham and Tyler Williams up front. Third down coming. This is what Kark was talking about. So obviously it's cool. Elijah Collins, really good player. You know who his teammate was? Cassius Winston, State Spartans. That's not too bad either.
Well, they're going to need him. I'm surprised they're throwing the ball. They should be milking the clock a little bit, but they're going to need him to carry the rock here. And you know, run this clock out a little bit. They're going to have to throw it here. I think they're going to want a first down. Not easy to come by, third and long.
Lewerke, back shoulder, White with a twist and catch out across the 40. Two clutch throws by Brian Lewerke on this drive to get him out across the 40.
You said it, Adam. This is a perfect back shoulder throw, and it's not even really tight man coverage. The defender's playing high over the top. This is just an excellent throw, and this coaching staff trusts their senior quarterback to be smart with the football.
Now the clock ducks inside of 6 minutes to play, and it feels like no hurry for Michigan State.
Yeah, no hurry at all. I just got to say real quickly about Elijah Collins being a basketball player and Mark D'Antonio talking about, hey, he should play football. Both of these programs have guys that were multi-sport athletes in high school.
Oh, dangerous pass, but Mosley comes down with it. Amari Henderson was there to maybe make a play, but Mosley, the true freshman, comes up with the biggest catch of his season.
And this is another great athlete like we're talking about. Trey Mosley has come on huge the last two games. This was a guy, like you said, a true freshman. They thought maybe they were going to redshirt him. Plays against Maryland, has 73 yards. But I will tell you, he could have had 100 and something. Trey Mosley is a guy that Brian Lewerke believes in. Brad Salem believes in.
Yep.
That was a huge play for Michigan State.
And now Lewerke on the ground. Ducking ahead to the 30. Lewerke has now surpassed 300 passing yards for the fourth time this year. He had a season high in the bowl clinching win against Maryland, 342. 319 today.
And all of that is great. All of that is great. I really appreciate that.
Sure.
My good friend Steve Young will say, what you do from the 20 to the 20 is great, but what you do inside the 20, both the plus 20 and the minus 20, is most important.
We've got two touchdowns and five trips today. Run in the reverse. Good adjustment by Naylor. Penalty marker thrown. Gets run down by Jaquez Williams past the sticks, but we'll check the flag back at the 35.
Holding by number 64 of the offense. It's a 10-yard penalty, and it's still second down.
There's Matt Allen. He started the first eight games at center before a left knee injury. Has been playing multiple positions this year, and he got tagged with the holding penalty as he grabbed Manny Walker.
That's a Big 12 holding penalty, I guess. I don't see it. I didn't see that one. Getting back to Steve Young and what you do from the 20 to the 20, you know, the last two drives in Wake territory, you know, Michigan State has had two turnovers. They have the interception and then the fumble. So protecting the football here is paramount.
The work he keeps. Nice move to get around Rucker, and he runs it for a first down inside the 20-yard line. Smile on the face after a little shimmy and shake for 24.
Well, the senior is putting this team on his back offensively. They started this drive at their own 15-yard line. He goes one-on-one with a freshman free safety. The free safety wanted nothing to do with that senior quarterback running right at him. Nice play by Lewerke, and now they're inside the red zone.
And in field goal range, which is key. If they get 3 points, that's a two-score game as we get closer to 3.5 minutes remaining. And this play clock getting milked down. Mark D'Antonio, again, he and Brad Salem in no hurry.
This is where clock management, using your timeouts, come into play for Wake Forest as well.
Hand off Collins. Couple yards on the play. Jaquez Williams on the stop, and there is the first usage of a timeout. .318 on the clock. First timeout used by the Demon Deacons. Second down coming up. Again, we've still got two more bowl games. Texas Bowl and Cheez-It Bowl. And after the Cheez-It Bowl, Linda Cohn and Neil Everett We'll step up with SportsCenter from Los Angeles. They'll preview the college football playoff semis for Eastern tomorrow. That's when it starts up on ESPN. A conversation with Ed Ogeron of LSU and reports from the Cowboys and Eagles. Eagles win, they win the East. Eagles lose and Cowboys beat the Redskins. The Cowboys win the NFC East. All that coming up after Air Force and Wazoo on ESPN and SportsCenter tonight.
You know what I love, Adam?
What's
like
up?
I travel a lot this year. If you miss something in sports, all you got to do is na-na-na. It's got it all.
Well done.
Just catch up. Just catch right up on it. I have a feeling that there's going to be some plays from this game that are going to be
very worthy of it. Second and seven for Lewerke. Oh yeah, trying to run that same little shovel up the middle to Gillison. That was the play he fumbled the ball on a previous play. He gets wrapped up quickly here. Third down and a timeout. Whew. Things getting a little, that's a puff out your cheeks moment right there. It's getting tight down the stretch in the Bronx. When we finish up here in the Bronx, we'll take it down to Houston, Texas. Old Big 12 matchup between the old rivals Oklahoma State and Kellen Mond of the Texas A&M Aggies. The San Antonio native will go to work for Texas A&M. Fun game coming up. You have to see Chuba Hubbard in action as well. But we've got a great finish down the stretch here at the Pinstripe Bowl. Michigan State with a 6-point lead, 3:12 to play. Mark D'Antonio had to talk to Brian Lewerke after that last shovel pass and say, hey, let's be a little bit more careful here, pal.
He's like, make it a two-score game, please. I've said it the last two drives. Just make it a two-score game.
It's Collins on the run, wrapped up shy of the sticks at the 10 by Schmenda. Will Wake Forest use a timeout or save one? They'll use their last timeout here, and it's going to come down to Matt Coughlin, redshirt junior out of Cincinnati, Ohio, who's already been good from 23 yards today. This is going to be a big kick to try to make it a two-score lead. Of course, when we're done, we'll take you to the Texas Bowl on ESPN, but on the ESPN app, you can tune in for the post-game trophy ceremony presented by Capital One immediately following our contest.
Yeah, you mentioned Coughlin. Dave Clausen's using the timeouts. They're doing that part right. Coughlin's done his job right tonight. 2 for 2 tonight with field goals, but came into the game tonight a little shaky, only 69% on the season. They believe in him, particularly in this section of the field.
Right.
You mentioned he's from Cincinnati, great Moeller High School prospect. Coach D'Antonio said, hey, I got faith in him, I got trust in him, confidence in him, and he's got it in himself.
He's hit game winners before. Could this seal it? On the way, it is no good. And it's still a one-score game. Matt Coughlin has hit 3 game winners in his career. This one would have been essentially good for a game winner to make it a 2-score lead with the waning minutes here in the Pinstripe Bowl. But he knew he had pushed that one from the start. And Dave Clausen, his 9-win season hopes are still alive with 3 minutes to play in the Bronx.
Man, this game has been unbelievable. Last 3 drives into Wake territory look like Michigan State could put it away. They've come away with no points. That's not an easy kick from the left hash. I know you're close. It's not easy. Still, you expect Coughlin to make it, but let's see what Jamie Newman can do. He has not completed a high percentage of his passes tonight.
And that one got dropped by Frudenthal.
He's going to need to step up on this drive. We've seen him do it before this season. Can he do it tonight, Adam?
Second down coming up. Inside of 3 to play. No timeouts remaining for Wake Forest. They have been in this spot plenty under Dave Clausen and this year. This is their 6th game that could be decided by 1 score or less this season. Newman. That ball may have been deflected out of his hands. Kendall Hinton smartly picks it up because it might have been a lateral, and Hinton's going to keep running it and work himself back to about the 16-yard line, and Jamie Newman's a little bit banged up after that play, and Dave Clausen can't stop the clock. Kenny Willekes.
This is a big play by Willekes to get the hit on Jamie Newman. Jamie Newman, if he can't go, should stay on the field, lay down for an injury timeout.
And again, there was no ruling of an incomplete pass on that play, and Kendall Hinton did a very smart thing on a potential live ball by picking it up. Now, this is reviewable because there is a pass or fumble potential in this play. Willekes with the pressure. It's hard to tell. And this is such a subjective call. Is his hand coming forward? To me, it looks like a pass. And then the other question is, if it's a pass, which is my opinion only, did it go forward or was it thrown behind the line of scrimmage?
Exactly. That's well said by you, Adam. Those are the two things that they got to look for in the booth. And again, it's got to be indisputable video evidence.
Because the call on the field was fumble, and it was picked up by Hinton, and then he ran it. So now let's take a look if this is a forward pass or perhaps a lateral based on the trajectory of the ball. So he's at about the 13 when he's releasing it. That ball flutters out and lands, I think, at the 14.
Yeah.
So that would be an incompletion. That's also big because that would put a bunch of time back on the clock. Like, you see the clock at 2:47. The clock right now on the stadium scoreboard is at 2:29. So that would be a key 18 seconds added back on or so.
And I cannot say enough about Kenny Willekes.
Yeah.
I feel like I just keep talking about this guy. Maybe it's because I saw him do a flip on a snowboard, and as a big guy, I'm impressed by that. But his effort, he was double teamed on that play, blocked by two guys. One of them ended up on the ground. The other guy ended up behind him, and he ended up all over Jamie Newman, who now is limping off the field.
Now Cooper Castleberry is communicating. Our replay official is Gene Semko, again, Big 12 crew. This is a key call coming up.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. Please set the clock to 2:45.
So now, in this case, this gives me the sense that the ball was punched out by Willekes. If that's the case, if that's how they call it, because there was no ruling of an incomplete pass on the field, so that must be ruled as a fumble. And now, because as you said, Matt, Jamie Newman's so banged up, here comes a guy who's been in big spots, has started games, including this year, a guy you actually think is pretty good. Sam Hartman, the sophomore, steps in a huge spot.
Yeah, I actually think that his skill set might be better suited for a two-minute drive anyway. Third and long, don't be surprised here if Wake Forest has already called the fourth down play in the huddle.
Three-man rush for Michigan State. The first play for Sam Hartman in the ball game is incomplete, looking for Green. Had Trey Person in coverage, and it brings up fourth down. Sam Hartman cold off the bench and launching it, and Donovan Green is a little bit slow to get up after that play.
Wow. Sam Hartman, he's got 20 career touchdowns. That could have been 21 again. Just a little bit more air for both of these quarterbacks gets them a completion there. I know it's hard. You've been sitting around for 2 hours watching the game. This is an excellent play call. It looked like Xavier Henderson got a little way with just a little bit of a tug there. But again, they talk about Green and his ability, his big play ability. Maybe the most talented guy
sure.
in the wide receiver room.
That's
when it's all said and done. The freshman from North Carolina has a chance there to just run away with this game if
yeah.
he was given an opportunity. But a long foul ball, as they say.
So Newman's on the bench. Sam Hartman is appearing in a game for the fourth time this year, as you see Green holding his nose, perhaps on that hit on the ground. Maybe he made some contact with his helmet towards his nose. He's heading back towards the bench now as well. So you lose a big play threat right there. Fourth down coming up. Hartman can redshirt, by the way. This is only his fourth appearance. He's a true sophomore, so they can still redshirt him after this year. Made a start this season against Florida State after coming in for an injured Newman against Louisville. It comes down to this. Wake Forest out of timeout, still above 2 minutes left, so the game wouldn't be mathematically over. But still, a huge opportunity for Michigan State to put themselves in position to win it. Wake needs 14 yards. Another three-man rush. Hartman spinning away from Willekes. Still on his feet. They need the 30-yard line. Hartman stops, fires! Incomplete! Turnover on downs, it's Michigan State ball.
I'm amazed there's not a penalty flag. I'm looking all around for a penalty flag. There was contact in the backfield. There was a great pass rush. Looked like clean football, but just surprising. Excellent effort by Hartman, who came in. Willett gets on the chase. Michigan State sideline is electric right now. They realize what they've just done. They pitched a shutout in the second half of this game at Yankee Stadium. Sorry, in the fourth quarter at Yankee Stadium. To probably, and I say probably, seal the victory.
Yep. Depending on how much time is burnt off after each play, you could burn the rest of this clock out. It'd be close. But Wake Forest, no matter what, cannot stop the clock. They're out of timeouts. Extra body in the backfield as well is Jacob Isaiah as a blocker for Collins, who got tripped up by Isaiah on that play. But it keeps the clock moving.
Yeah, and this is the play I'm talking about. Obviously, Wake would rather have Jamie Newman in there, but I think Sam Hartman gives him a chance, and he almost does.
Yeah, A.T. Really, Perry was right there.
Really great effort. And I think what's interesting to me right there on that play, Wake Forest was going to let Michigan State score.
Yeah, good call.
So they got the ball back. And ironically, probably by accident, Jacob. Elijah Collins trips on his own guy.
Yeah, Isaiah, who hadn't really been in the game, he's basically the second fullback, just ends up going down to the ground, and Collins trips over it. So the play clock will wind all the way down to take off as much time as possible. A minute 29 remaining. Brian Lewerke, moments away from closing out a 38-start career with a victory. He's gotten to the top of the total offense charts in Michigan State history, and he's had an impressive performance in many phases.
Well, we talked to him. We said, what would it mean to get this victory? What would it mean to break some of these Michigan State records and make your mark on Michigan State history? And you could just see the look on his face, how much it meant to him, all that these guys have been through, all that these 21 seniors have been through. And really a gritty performance by him. They had the turnovers. And I think, Adam, you've got some news for us.
Breaking news, guys. He's our Capital One player of the game. Couple of completions shy of Kirk Cousins' record, but he passes Connor Cook for the most productive quarterback in Michigan State history in terms of yardage. Three backs in the backfield again, really two fullbacks and Collins. And again, Wake Forest has just said, hey, go ahead and score. And Collins recognizes it. They get the first down, and that will do it.
And that's smart football by Wake Forest by trying to let them score. And it's smart football by Elijah Collins, the redshirt freshman, to go down. Reminds me of my old teammate, Ahmad Bradshaw.
That's right, Super Bowl.
Super Bowl. It takes an unselfish running back to go down and take a knee.
That's a hard touchdown to give up.
And then at the next level, you really disappoint your fantasy owners.
Yes.
You
know, so yeah. Now at that point, here we're fine. But
but again, a credit to the second half that Michigan State had.
Yep. Especially defensively.
Defensively, yes.
No points allowed in the fourth quarter. Neither team scored, in fact, in the fourth quarter. But Brian Lewerke has got to take one more victorious knee to close out his Michigan State career. Goes for 320 yards.
Not bad for a kid from Tacoma who moved to Arizona, who met Kirk Cousins on his recruiting trip to Michigan State and said, yeah, why not? I see what you're talking about. I'll take a turn up here at Michigan State, see what East Lansing's all about. Nice way to go out for him and the rest of the senior class.
Great season for Wake Forest, which will finish at 8-5. Could this be one of those jump-starting wins for the veteran Mark D'Antonio at the helm of this Michigan State program? That's what he was hoping for. 7-6 looks a lot better than 6-7, he said. And he rides Brian Lewerke and this Michigan State defense to a 6-point win. On the ESPN app for our Capital One trophy presentation. Next on ESPN, the Academy Sports and Outdoors Texas Bowl. For Matt Hasselbeck, Paul Carcaterra, and the great women and men of our crew, Adam Amin, saying so long.
Coach, You held them scoreless in that second half. What was the difference?
I thought our defense just kept continuing to shut down the quarterback running lanes in the second half. Got some pressure on him. I thought we made some sacks and really eliminated the deep ball as well.
How would you describe the performance of Brian Lewerke?
Gutty, gritty. That's a huge play down here for the first down down here, and his throws coming out the back line. The board, but did it the hard way.
What's been the most enjoyable thing about this team?
Our resilience. Keep people playing. And our chemistry of our people and our love for each other. Thank you so much, guys.
This is the New Era Pinstripe Bowl Trophy Ceremony presented by Capital One. The festivities down on the field are about to begin, but first, this message.
Promise that you'll never find another like me.
With the Capital One Saver Card, you earn 4% cash back on dining and 4% on entertainment. So when you go out, you cash in. What's in your wallet?
Brian Lewerke, in the 38th and final start of his career, comes away with a 6-point victory. He passes Connor Cook for the all-time total offense mark from a Michigan State quarterback in its long program's history. And a great close to his career as he gets to celebrate with his family and get a handshake from Booney, Aaron Boone, manager of the New York Yankees.
Stadium. How awesome is that? And, you know, you see him throw on the Pinstripe Bowl champion's hat. Those are the hats. Those are the trophies that you have forever. Aaron Boone, a family friend. I think they attended the same church in Arizona when he was living there. But honestly, to close out your career as a quarterback at Michigan State, your senior year, you get to play in the Pinstripe Bowl in Yankee Stadium. And that hat, I know it's silly and I don't know how much that hat costs, but that hat is going to mean more in 50 years than a lot of things that he has in his possession. And, you know, I even have a trophy case at home, and I've got an old beat up Orange Bowl hat that my dad had from a Colorado versus Ohio State game in 1977. So for the Lewerke family, that New Era Pinstripe Bowl hat, that's really, really special.
That's going to trigger a really nice memory for him down the line whenever he gets an opportunity to look back on what was an excellent college career.
And I'm going to keep those grass stains on that jersey. If you get to keep your jersey after, I'm not sure how that works, but do not wash those grass stains out. Those are Yankee Stadium grass stains. I would leave those on just like it.
Well, let's take a look at tonight's Capital One rewarding performance. And no surprise, right at the top of the list, Brian Lewerke, who threw for over 300 yards, ran for a touchdown, passed for a touchdown, and had an overall very solid performance, which is, I think, a very apt word to use for the entire career of Brian Lewerke.
Yeah, and fought back over some adversity as well. There were some turnovers. They did come away with no points in the red zone a couple times, but he answered back. And there was no quit in this team. There was perseverance. And I think that's really been kind of a storyline of this team, whether it's the leadership on defense of a great player like Kenny Willekes, or if you're talking about the guy on the other side, the senior quarterback, Brian Lewerke, putting his team on his back in a critical moment to persevere so they get to come home with some hardware. Very impressive, and they're having a lot of fun.
Kenny Willekes, part of a defense that held Wake Forest scoreless for 36 minutes. Kelly, how about that? Jim Kelly, Aaron Boone. This is some royalty we're talking about right now.
We are in New York City.
Absolutely.
Maybe the greatest city in the world, so I guess we shouldn't be surprised. But these kids, they're having a lot of fun.
Awesome to see. They're getting ready for that trophy presentation.
And how about the tight end,
Trenton Gillison?
you know, not only the big play, obviously the big play that set up the run for Lewerke on the touchdown, but fighting back, understanding that Rosenthal goes out and they don't have Seibert and Matt Dotson's not available and he's got to step up and play through injury. He had the fumble. He still goes back in the game, making plays. They go back to the same exact play that he fumbled on. The trust that they have. So I like it. I like the energy around this program. This is cool stuff to see these guys in their moment of celebration.
6-point Michigan State win in a season that was marred by injury and oftentimes inconsistency. That middle of the year run where they lost 5 consecutive games put them in a tough spot at 4-6, had to win their final 2 games and were able to knock off Rutgers and Maryland to secure bowl eligibility for a 12th time in 13 years under Mark D'Antonio, and a little sly smirk on the face of that veteran head coach from El Paso, Texas.
Yeah, I'm kind of a gear guy here, but I'm not hating these hats. The Yankee beanie.
Absolutely.
With the Michigan State Spartan. I like that.
Part of the gift suite, too, that a lot of these players got a chance to experience. This is an awesome experience. First class operation here at Yankee Stadium, run by the New York Yankees. It's bowl game in its 10th season of the current iteration of Yankee Stadium. The 17th college football game that's been played in this facility. And we had a great ball game, not only because of a close game, but 5 lead changes in this contest. Yep. Wake Forest gave us a great game, came right down to the final minutes. A lot of fun here in the Bronx.
And you mentioned Brian Lewerke, you know, breaking some Michigan State quarterback records. Well, I got to give a shout out to Kenny Willekes. He broke my old teammate Julian Peterson's TFL, tackle for loss record at Michigan State previously. He did it earlier this season, and I know what kind of player Julian Peterson was at the next level, and it wouldn't surprise me at all if Kenny Willekes was that kind of a player in the NFL.
He and Lewerke both playing their final games in a Michigan State uniform. They close their careers with a victory. Well, down to the field we go. Paul Carcaterra anchors our ceremonies.
Here to present the championship trophy to head coach Mark D'Antonio of the victorious.
Way to go, guys. Thank you.
Michigan State Spartans, from the New York Yankees, managing general partner Hal Steinbrenner.
Coach, on behalf of the entire Yankee organization, congratulations. Great game, great win.
Thank you very much.
This is you. You want it?
That's what I want. Wait. Oh, yeah, my partner.
There we go.
Coach, you got Spartan Nation behind you, but they can hear you. How would you describe your defensive effort in that second half?
Great second half. Really shut down the running lanes, I thought, and no explosive plays, and just kept playing. And resilience, relentless. We said coming into the game, we need to be relentless, and that's what we got.
Your quarterback, Brian Lewerke, all-time leader in total yards offense for Michigan State. Describe what he's meant to this program.
Great playmaker, throwing the ball off the back end zone out there. Big plays, a couple big plays down the stretch, and then big run down here at the end of the game to sort of seal it up a little bit. So outstanding competitor, and can't say enough about him. He's been a guy.
What'd you enjoy most about New York during the holidays?
We like to win. It makes it all better, but great people in New York. A lot of Spartans came, and seeing all the sights and just experiencing things for our players, it's a great moment for us.
Thank you, Coach. Congratulations.
Thanks so much. Thanks for coming, guys. Go Green!
And now, to present the most valuable player award trophy to Brian Lewerke from Michigan State. Please welcome again from New Era, President and CEO Chris Cook, Vice President of Sports Marketing and Corporate Partnerships Josh Fine, and NFL Hall of Famer Jim Kelly.
Go Red!
Brian, come on in. You got to talk. What's this moment like for you as a senior to cap it off and all the personal accolades and a pinstripe trophy MVP in your hand?
Feels incredible. You know, this team played, it went through a lot this year, and the seniors have been through a lot, and to finish it this way is incredible.
Why has this team been so resilient?
That's what Michigan State is. That's what Coach D preaches. That's what we do. We keep fighting. We keep battling all game long.
What's it like when you hear your name at the top of the charts now today? Because today you broke that record, all-time leader in overall yards at Michigan State. What's it like for you to hear that?
It's pretty cool. You know, I never thought that would happen, but you know, I owe it to all my teammates, everyone that that have played with me this year, past years. I owe it all to them.
Let's give it up for Brian Lewerke, MVP of the Pinstripe Bowl. Congratulations again, Michigan State, for winning the 2019 New Era Pinstripe Bowl. Fans, we look forward to seeing you back here at Yankee Stadium on April 2nd, 2020 for the Yankees home opener. Happy New Year, everyone. Drive home safe.